Hello friends, welcome all to Search Test Urology Immersion course. Today's discussion will be on urodynamic evaluation and urogenic bladder. I understand this is such a vast topic, so we'll try to get the concepts behind the urodynamic evaluation and its allied components, and we'll also, if time permits, take some urodynamic tracings and try to decode it. So I once again welcome you all. So let me start with why urodynamics? What is the clinical utility of urodynamics? In other words, what are the indications for urodynamics? If this is going to be a one-word question, so a quick answer would be lower urinary tract dysfunction. So any patient with lower urinary tract dysfunction, you can go ahead and do a urodynamics. But what is the result you are going to achieve with urodynamics? What are you specifically looking for in urodynamic, and how it would help us to prognosticate the condition, and will it really change the management? Those are the situations in which you need to really do this complex text of urodynamics. Otherwise, you can just go ahead with management. So we'll also see some scenarios where, even though the diagnosis is a bit complex, some sort of incontinence, what the societies, the various associations say is, you really do not require any sort of urodynamic evaluation. Just can go ahead, you can, the whole diagnosis is nothing but a clinical diagnosis, and you can go ahead with management. But there are certain specific conditions where your urodynamic evaluation will play a role in understanding the causative factors of the disease, to define the disease per se, to evaluate the management, and for the follow-up also. So amongst the various utilities of urodynamics, we could just club them into five different causes. The first is identifying the various factors contributing to lower urinary tract dysfunction. So a patient presents to you, take a 60-year-old male, presents to you with voiding LUTS. So let me just clarify to you what is meant by voiding LUTS and what is meant by storage LUTS. Remember, the ICS, the International Continence Society, has just renamed the older terms. So the older terms were obstructive lower urinary tract symptoms and irritative lower urinary tract symptoms. So what did they rename the obstructive LUTS as? What it is renamed as obstructive LUTS, I think it's not a newer term, because we have already discussed this in benign prostate enlargement class. Yes, but it is also known as voiding LUTS, and irritative also known as storage LUTS. So remember, storage LUTS, you can just summarize them into fun. Frequency, urgency, and nocturia. Do you guys remember the mnemonic for avoiding LUTS? Is anybody? When you take the IPSS, that is the International Prostate Symptom Score. Excellent. So you can just summarize it as this. So poor stream, intermittency, straining to void, and sense of incomplete emptying. So remember, coming back to the first utility. So we have a 60-year-old male who presents to you with voiding LUTS, and on physical examination you find a grade 2 prostate. And what is the next investigation you would do? Yes, we have a 60-year-old male with voiding LUTS, and on physical examination you are finding a grade 2 prostate, which is non-nodular. It is just firm, no hard nodules are there. Yes, anybody? What is the next line of investigation? Would you straight away do a urodynamic evaluation? Excellent. So getting an answer that you will do an ultrasound. Okay, according to, remember, if you actually go to the guidelines, remember, ultrasound, abdomen is not something that is indicated. What they are saying is ultrasound of the prostate. Of course, if you are going to examine the prostate, you might as well evaluate the upper tracts with an ultrasound. But the guidelines are all based on Western literature, and the Western literature primarily runs on insurance models. So remember, ultrasound of the prostate, you need to be a bit specific. Ultrasound of the prostate, and of course, Excellent. Postvital residue evaluation. Remember, the term you have used, PVR, postvital residue of urine itself, remember, is a part of urodynamic evaluation. So that itself, we'll start this urodynamic evaluation. Excellent. So next to the line of investigation would be USG with PVR. And then probably we can go ahead and do a neuroflowmetry. Yes? You guys agree with that? Yes. So patient is an index patient. By index, I mean the symptoms and signs correlate to the age of the patient and the physical examination and the probably your radiological examination also, like your enlarged prostate or some cross-sectional study you are doing. Then your role of urodynamic testing is limited. Whereas you have a mixed type of symptoms. For example, he's having some sort of irritative symptoms and obstructive symptom, and on examination, you are not able to find enlarged prostate. And if you have some doubts with regard to the diagnosis, there is the clear cut indication for an urodynamic evaluation. So the next point would be to predict the consequences of lower urinary tract dysfunction on upper tract. So this is again a bit self-explanatory. So you want to find whether the upper tracts have already involved, if there is any hydronephrosis on your ultrasound, or basically to find if your bladder is safe enough for the upper tracts. In other words, we have to find certain parameters. We'll discuss what those parameters, like DLPP. Remember this term, DLPP, detrusor leak point pressure. And remember this one more numerical I want you to remember in this class is 40 centimeters of water. So remember, detrusor leak point pressure, if it is greater than 40 centimeters of water, it is going to be detrimental to the upper tract. The next point is to predict the consequences and outcomes of therapeutic intervention. Again, this is not a controversial point. When you take various diseases and look at their guidelines, nowhere does it mention, you have to do urodynamic evaluation to predict the consequences of your treatment. It is not that before you do an invasive treatment, for example, a TURP, or for example, for that matter, take a midurethral sling. So you have a stress urinary incontinence patient and you are seeing the patient is having urethral hypermobility, yes, and not managed by all the conservative methods, yes, you can go ahead with a surgery like a midurethral sling. There is no indication for a urodynamic evaluation even in that scenario. Similarly for a TURP. But if the diagnosis is a bit muddied, you can go ahead with urodynamic basically to understand the disease. And to be very honest, urodynamics could not predict the outcomes of therapeutic intervention to a greater extent, at least as of now, when you take the present urology as concern. Next point is to confirm and understand the effects of intervention. So again, this is a very important point. So for example, you have done an augmental cystoplasty for a neurogenic bladder patient. So before you have done this augmentation cystoplasty, you understood that the bladder is a bit unsafe. You have measured the various parameters like compliance, the DLPP, everything. And then you have augmented the patient. And after that, you have to understand whether your surgery has really helped the patient. Again, as the means of follow-up, yes, you can go ahead and do an urodynamic evaluation. So of course, it helps to understand the effects of your intervention, like your augmentation cystoplasty. And finally, this is a very important point, to investigate the reasons for treatment failure. As I said earlier, you have a 60 or 70 year old male with voiding LUTS, and then you are going ahead with an invasive treatment like a TURP, and then on the third or fourth day, you are removing the catheter and the patient fails to void. Of course, there could be multitudes of problems why the patient fails to void. There could be a clot, there could be a tissue bit that is blocking him, but the most sinister problem would be an underactive detrusor. So if you have failed to pick up such an underactive detrusor in your pre-op evaluation, again, after the treatment failure, you can go ahead with a urodynamic evaluation to understand that the detrusor is not really functioning. Similarly for, say, stress urinary incontinence, you have done some sort of a procedure, say a midurethral sling, or the olden techniques like your Bush corpus suspension. Again, that technique has terribly failed. The patient is again leaking on stress. Then probably you go ahead and do an urodynamic evaluation only to find that the patient is suffering from an intrinsic sphincter deficiency. So this is not something that is that is MCQ related, but I want you to understand this slide very much. So we are seeing the various uses or the indications of urodynamics. The first thing is to identify the factors contributing to lower urinary tract dysfunction, to predict the consequences of lower urinary tract dysfunction on the upper tracts. There is a measurement called detrus or leak point pressure. We'll just discuss this in the future slides, but remember the term called DLPP and the value called 40 centimeters of water. So if the DLPP is greater than 40 centimeters of water, remember it is detrimental to the upper tract. I would explain the principles behind the DLPP and how to measure the DLPP and so on and so forth in the future sense. But remember just the term called DLPP and the value of 40 centimeters of water. So if the DLPP is greater than 40 centimeters of water, remember it is going to be detrimental to the upper tract. The other indications would be you do urodynamic evaluation to predict the consequences and outcomes of therapeutic intervention, to confirm and understand the effects of your therapeutic intervention, and basically to investigate the reasons why your treatment has failed. So again, dwelling on this topic of indications for urodynamic evaluation a bit more, this is something that is that could be asked in your MCQ. Again, this was asked in a couple of years back. Basically, do you do urodynamic evaluation for a straightforward stress urinary incontinence? So remember, the answer is no. For a case of straightforward stress urinary incontinence, you have a female, and on clinical evaluation, you are finding that the patient is having a stress urinary incontinence, no other problem on physical examination. Probably you can go ahead and do a PVR, but other parts of urodynamic evaluation like your systemetrogram or your pressure flow study is not indicated for a straightforward stress urinary incontinence. So remember, this is a very important point you must take home today. Remember, for a straightforward case of stress urinary incontinence in a female, in a prototypical index female, your urodynamic evaluation has got no role. Even if you're going to plan an invasive procedure like a midurethral sling, you can go ahead with your treatment. Your urodynamic evaluation is not going to change your line of management. So when will you do a urodynamic evaluation in a case of stress incontinence is while doing your physical examination, if you are not able to appreciate the urethral hypermobility. Yes, if you are able to appreciate the urethral hypermobility, yes, you can go ahead and do probably the procedure of choice in today's world, that is your midurethral slings. You can go ahead and do that, or your autologous slings. But if you are not able to appreciate the urethral hypermobility, what do you think could be the probable pathology causing the stress urinary incontinence? Yes, anybody? There is no urethral hypermobility and still the patient has stress urinary incontinence. What do you think is the pathology causing stress urinary incontinence? Excellent. It is going to be your intrinsic sphincter deficiency. So to document this intrinsic sphincter deficiency, you can go ahead with and do an urodynamic evaluation. You can appreciate this you can define this intrinsic sphincter deficiency based on two values. One, you can do an urethral profile, urethral pressure profilometry, or you can do something known as cough leak point pressure, or your Valsalva leak point pressure, or your abdominal leak point pressure. All the three are same, and you can define this ISD. Remember, if ISD is there, yes, it might change your line of management. So remember, SUI without hypermobility, yes, there is an indication for stress urinary incontinence. Next is again self-explanatory failed incontinence surgery. As we have already discussed this, you do any invasive procedure and your symptoms are still there or new symptoms arise, then there is a role for your urodynamic evaluation. Next, this is an important point, to assess for occult stress urinary incontinence while planning prolapse surgery. So remember, a patient with UV prolapse, so uterovaginal prolapse is there, it is mandatory that during your physical examination, you reduce the UV prolapse and check for stress urinary incontinence, because basically what would have happened is your prolapse would have kinked the urethra. So that would have masked the underlying stress urinary incontinence, which is coexisting with your UV prolapse. So remember, during examination, for a case of uterovaginal prolapse, it is mandatory that you reduce the prolapse if it is possible and check for stress urinary incontinence, because the prolapse would have just kinked the urethra and masked the stress urinary incontinence. That would be a big headache if you are going to treat the UV prolapse and not treat the SUA, because the patient is going to present with SUA after your prolapse surgery. And similarly, for like stress urinary incontinence, the case of straightforward urge urinary incontinence, that is basically your OAB. So what is OAB, overactive bladder? It is a symptom complex of frequency, urgency, nocturia with or without urinary incontinence, and all the diseases that cause this storage symptoms are ruled out, like infection or malignancy or radiation is ruled out, then it is a case of overactive bladder. So remember, for a case of straightforward overactive bladder, that is a combination of urgency, frequency, and nocturia with or without urgency, urge incontinence, remember, urodynamic evaluation is not indicated. So remember, you can go ahead with your treatment. What are the treatments? It could be your pelvic floor exercises, biofeedback. You can go ahead with your, say, anticholinergics or a Botox injection. Yes, you can go ahead with various therapies of overactive bladder. Need not do a urodynamic evaluation at all. But for something, again, just like stress urinary incontinence, if you are invasive in treatment or your first and second line treatment, like your Botox and anticholinergics and your biofeedback has failed, then there is a role for urodynamic evaluation. So remember, both stress urinary incontinence and urge urinary incontinence are basically clinical diagnosis. You can go ahead with treatment. Really, you need not depend on urodynamic evaluation to define the disease. But if the patient is having a mixed urinary incontinence, so what is mixed urinary incontinence? Both stress plus urge urinary incontinence. So if the patient is having a mixed urinary incontinence, to basically define the disease itself, so define that the patient is having a mixed urinary incontinence, it is mandatory that you do a urodynamic evaluation, number one, and to see which symptom complex is severe. For example, if the urge component is severe or your stress component is severe, to define all those things, it is mandatory that you do a urodynamic evaluation. So again, this reiterates the older point. What I'm saying is the patient is not an index patient. So if there is something that does not correlate when you compare the age, your symptom complex, your physical examination, and your radiological examination, if there is some problem along this diagnosis, like your mixed presentation or a mixed urinary incontinence, you have to go ahead and do an urodynamic evaluation. And you should also do this urodynamic evaluation for a case of treatment failure. So this is something we have discussed already. Any patient with lower urinary tract symptoms, it is enough that you can just stop your evaluation with postoidal residue, but to actually define an obstruction, for example, this was brought up just to negate the downside of your uroflowmetry. So for example, if the patient is having a low flow pattern on an uroflowmetry, basically what could be the reason for this low flow? It could be either bladder outlet obstruction or what would it be other than bladder outlet obstruction? The patient is having a low flow, so his peak is low, his Qmax is low. Neurogenic bladder, could you be a bit more specific? No, you don't call that neurogenic. You have to be a bit more specific. It is detrus or underactive. It is basically an underactive bladder. So remember, your uroflowmetry cannot differentiate a bladder outlet obstruction from a detrus or underactivity. So for that reason, you can go ahead and do a pressure flow study to basically define bladder outlet obstruction. Okay. Next is your neurogenic bladder. So remember, neurogenic bladder of any cause, be it spinal cord injury or multiple sclerosis or say Parkinson's or anything, tether cord syndrome, ALS or whatever you want, UD is mandatory. We will see why UD is mandatory and what are the effects of evaluation in your urodynamic evaluation and the prognosis, how your urodynamic evaluation changes your treatment plan. And it is just not the symptom complex behind which you should be running while treating a neurogenic bladder a bit more later. So remember, any case of neurogenic bladder, you have to do one urodynamic evaluation. Next is your incontinence status post trauma or pelvic surgery or radiation cystitis or prior radiation or trauma or pelvic surgery. If there is some form of incontinence, after your say a pelvic fracture or urethral distraction defect or your previous surgery or radiation, you have to basically understand what is the problem that is causing your incontinence, whether it is the problem of the bladder, problem of the outlet. So to understand the disease process, you have to do a urodynamic evaluation. And the last indication is a bit relative only. So recurrent UTI, especially the pediatric population. So pediatric recurrent UTI, the first diagnosis, the first investigation of choice would be your, yes, what would be your investigation of choice for a patient with recurrent UTI in a pediatric population? Yes. Excellent. It will be your MCUG. Also, I'm getting an answer of ultrasound examination. So basically, you can go ahead with MCU or USG based on whether you follow the bottom-up protocol or your top-down school of thought. So top-down, they say first evaluate the kidneys and go ahead with your bladder evaluation. Your bottom up is just the opposite. Again, both the school of thought have their own pros and cons. So after this evaluation of MCG and USG, for a case of recurrent UTI, you can go ahead with your urodynamic evaluation, basically to find out and define the diagnosis of a dysfunctional voider or bladder bowel dysfunction and so on and so forth. So basically, we have seen the various indications of urodynamic evaluation. The ultimate aim is to evaluate the lower factors that cause the lower urinary tract dysfunction and to basically screen and see whether the upper tracts are safe, to see whether the bladder is a safe bladder or an unsafe bladder for the upper tracts, and to evaluate the treatment failure process. We do an urodynamic evaluation. Now let us go to the topic proper. So what are the tests that are included in this urodynamic evaluation? As I said earlier, your postoidal residue also is a form of urodynamic evaluation, although it is a bit simpler test. You can evaluate the postoidal residue by an ultrasound examination, or after voiding, you can in fact catheterize the patient and then calculate the postoidal residue. So it is a basic test, which is again a part of urodynamic evaluation. The other test being uroflowmetry, cystometrogram. If you just combine the cystometrogram with the neuroflowmetry, what do you get? You get this pressure flow study. And then there is evaluation of the urethra, that is known as your urethral pressure profilometry, which we will not be discussing in detail in this class now. And then a combination of VCUG with the urodynamic evaluation, that is known as video urodynamics. Then a sphincter evaluation that by means of your electromyogram. Basically, what you understand in your electromyogram is that we are not actually seeing the current potential of the sphincter per se, but in fact calculating the voltage potential of the pelvic floor muscles, which have the same innervation as that of the sphincter. So we'll discuss that in the future, and a combination of all these tests. So these are the various tests in the armamentarium of urodynamic evaluation. So a bit more physiology before going to the topic proper. So there are two phases, basically your bladder and the outlet, they help you to store the urine and to empty the urine. So this is again self-explanatory. During the storage phase, all the filling phase, you can understand that your detrusor should relax and your pressure in the detrusor that is in the bladder should be low. And during storage, your urethral pressure should be high and it should be basically competent to prevent any leakage. What happens in the emptying or the voiding phase? Your detrusor should contract and your urethra should relax. So my question to you would be, which should happen earlier in a voiding phase? Is it your detrusor contraction or your urethral relaxation? Which should precede? Which action should precede during a voiding or an emptying phase? I think this is a very very important question to basically understand the whole urodynamics. Okay, I'm getting some answers as detrusor contraction that should precede your urethral relaxation. Does everybody agree with that, or does anyone have an alternate view? Okay, I'm not getting any answer. Probably everyone is accepting with your detrusor contraction. So remember, the answer is the urethral relaxation should precede your detrusor contraction. So basically, this is something like your cardiac cycle. So what happens even before the ventricles contract, you will have your valves, that is your aortic valve and all, that they open and reduce the pressure for the for the ventricular contraction and the blood ejection. So similarly, the urethra, just like your heart should relax, that is the urethral relaxation should precede the detrusor contraction. This is a very important one, you must not forget. So again, this I would call, there are only 2-3 slides which I would ask you to learn by heart in this whole discussion. The first slide is going to be this one. So you are going to this, so this is some sort of a master slide, so you can just define the whole lower urinary tract dysfunction as a failure to store or a failure to empty. So how do you define this? What would be the inference of the urodynamic tracings is you define whether it is a problem to store the urine or a failure to empty the urine. If it is a problem to store the urine, then you have to define whether it is a problem of the bladder or the problem of the outlet. So if it is a failure to empty the urine, again you have to define whether it is a problem of the bladder or the problem of the outlet. So this would be the, remember, this would be the inference of any urodynamic tracing. So after you see the urodynamic tracing, you report the urodynamic tracing, basically your thinking should be whether it is a storage problem or is an emptying problem. If it is a storage problem, again the problem is localized to the bladder or the outlet. If it is an emptying problem, again the problem is localized to the bladder or it is localized to the outlet. Okay, now let us go into the evaluation of a patient. So basically, you guys would have some idea about this frequency volume chart, also known as your voiding diary or your bladder diary. So basically, when I was in, when I was a resident, basically in an academic institution, you will find that the patients, they come back with the bladder diary. Remember, this is a single most important test to evaluate the lower urinary tract symptoms. So remember, if there is one test which would help you to understand the whole pathology of your lower urinary tract symptoms, that is to have an introspection into the patient, and the patient can also have some idea about his bladder, it is this test called frequency volume chart or your bladder diary or your voiding diary. I think there are a lot of apps also, as you can see on the right side, there's a picture, there are a lot of apps to actually document the voiding patterns of a patient. So basically, name the one important inference that you get by this bladder diary or your voiding diary. I think this is a question which I've already discussed in your BPH class. Let me see if you could answer it. What is the single important impression that you get by seeing the bladder diary or a voiding diary? Yes, single important information. If you could just summarize after seeing the bladder diary or the voiding diary. No, it is not your frequency. Frequency is something that is not going to define the whole scenario, because the frequency can vary on everyday basis based on input and everything. Yeah, understand. You can define nocturia or nocturnal polyuria, all those things, but there is one thing that is of utmost care to help you to understand by this investigation called bladder diary or voiding diary. It is going to be your functional bladder capacity. Yes, I could see someone have answered it. Basically, bladder capacity. So why do you call it functional bladder capacity? There are various bladder capacities. Basically, functional means how much the patient can hold in reality. If the patient is under anesthesia, you do not have any bladder spasms at all. Basically, so he can have a true bladder capacity that can be measured under anesthesia. Then during your uroflow, urodynamics, that is your systometrogram, you can again measure your bladder capacity, that is known as your systometric capacity. Then you can measure it under scopy, that is cystoscopic capacity, but the capacity that you actually measure in his normal lifestyle, that is going to be your functional bladder capacity. So what is basically your bladder diary is, there are a lot of double columns, you know the time, you take the fluid intake, and you basically and note down the number of voids, frequency of voids, total amount of void, so that you can calculate the the patient is having any polyuria, or if the patient is having nocturia. What is nocturia? Basically, greater than in one portion of your standard textbook, that is Campbell, that is given as any. If the patient wakes even for a single time during his sleep, it is called nocturia. And in another place, it is given greater than one. So greater than, let us for all practical purposes keep it as greater than one void at night as nocturia. Again, you can define nocturia by seeing this voiding diary, or it is basically your nocturnal polyuria. What is the difference between nocturia and nocturnal polyuria? In other words, what is meant by nocturnal polyuria? So let me answer it. So if the patient basically voids greater than 1/3 of his total urinary volume at night, that is known as your nocturnal polyuria. Excellent. That is more than 33%. If he voids at night time or during his sleeping hour, that is known as the nocturnal polyuria. You can identify whether the patient is having nocturia or a nocturnal polyuria by based on this voiding diary only. And then you can see also document if the patient is having any, you know, incontinence episodes. And this is an important column. And what was the activity when the patient generally had leak? So basically, it will give you an idea what could trigger the, you know, trigger the bladder contraction, involuntary detrusor contraction. It will help you to guide, have some sort of idea. But whatever it is, the best inference that you get by this bladder diary or your voiding diary, that is going to be your functional bladder capacity. So what is basically functional bladder capacity is, for example, if the patient has got up at, you know, say 7 a.m., he had a coffee around 150 ml and he voided after some time as 300 ml, now 150, 350, say 8, 10, 1 p.m. and so on and so forth, get 250, 300. So what is going to be his functional bladder capacity? Yes, anybody? 300, 150, 350, 250, 300. Yes. What is going to be his functional bladder capacity on seeing this voiding diary? Yes, it is going to be your 350. So maximal, how much he can hold, it is this one. So that is going to be your functional bladder capacity. Why is it again important? It is, if you're asking the patient to do an uroflowmetry the next day after seeing this voiding diary, and he is able to void just say 100 ml, 150 ml, then you can probably convince him that your bladder can actually withhold at least 350 ml of urine. So better you repeat the test, you can ask him. So you basically can have some idea regarding the, you know, capacity of the bladder by seeing this functional bladder capacity, but basically by seeing this voiding diary. Okay. So of course, other things you can get on this voiding diary is your actually you can define what is polyuria or nocturia or your nocturnal polyuria. Next is going to be your, again, a bit more complex test that is known as your uroflowmetry. Again, you guys should have some idea about this uroflowmetry, I believe, already. So you have your on the x-axis you have your time, and on the y-axis you have your flow ml per minute. So what are the various results that you get on a uroflowmetry? Basically, you will get this important information called voided volume. So according to the recent textbook, recent edition of Campbell, what is the minimum voided volume that is required to validate the uroflowmetry? Is anybody? I know there is some answer in the slide, but I want you to answer. I want the correct answer. Excellent. So in the recent edition, what they have said is around 125 ml is required for the patient to void to actually validate such a uroflowmetry tracing. So remember, earlier people said around 150 ml is required, but recent editions they say even 125 ml is all that is required. And then you get an important result that is known as your Qmax. Again, amongst the various results that you get by uroflowmetry, which is going to be the single most important information or your single most important inference by this uroflowmetry tracing? Yes, it is. Is it your voided volume or your Qmax or Q average or your voiding time or your pattern? Yes. The single most important result is going to be your Qmax. Okay. then Q average. Basically, what is the advantage of this Q average is it is not very much helpful like your Q max, but it will help you to understand whether your Q max is based on some artifact. So remember a general rule, which is not 100%, but the general rule is, remember Q average is nearly 50% of Q max. So you have a tracing. So you have tracing like this. So he's going to ward and suddenly there is a spike and normal trough is there. Then this Q max will be around this value, but his Q average would be around here. So it is not actually 50%. So his Q max can be say around 25. His Q average would be around say 4. Does this correlate? So what I said already, your Q average should be around 50% of the Q max. In other words, it should be at least 12. So this will help you to identify that such a spike is nothing but an artifact. Probably this would have come because the patient had falsely kicked the bucket, basically the bucket on which the sensor is there, or there is some malformation with the sensor. So basically, Q average helps you to identify whether such a uroflowmetry tracing has some artifact or not, because remember, nearly your Q average would be around 50% of the Q max. So that is how your Q average helps. Next is an important inference that you get by this uroflowmetry is your flow pattern. So the normal flow pattern is supposed to be a smooth bell-shaped curve. In reality, we do not see this bell-shaped curve to be very honest. So one of the things that you know that you infer by this bell-shaped curve is it is smooth. So there are not spikes like this. Next is time to max. So time to max flow must be reached within 1/3 of the total flow time. So remember, that is why we have a bell-shaped curve that is skewed to the left. So remember, a normal bell-shaped curve, a Gaussian distribution will be like this, but a neurodynamic tracing basically should be like this, where the peak is reached nearly in 1/3 of the time when you take the whole warding time. Okay. So basically, your bell-shaped curve, a normal bell-shaped curve in a neuroflowmetry tracing should be skewed to the left. Then, of course, we'll find out the warded volume. We've already mentioned that at least 125 ml is necessary to validate the uroflowmetry curve. Next, Q average you have seen, that should be around 50% of the Q max. So can you guys give an example or give some idea about what could this uroflowmetry tracing diagnosis B? Yes, we have a Q max of say 37 ml per second. Yes, this one I would call this as normal, and this one, see, the Q max is only 6 ml per second. It is a flat curve, also known as plateau curve. What would be your diagnosis for such a case? A patient, a 35-year-old male, presents to you with voiding LUTS. On a neuroflowmetry, you find this status of a flat curve where his Q max is around 6 ml per. Yes, it could be stricture. Good. And what about this tracing? You have a peak, then it touches the baseline. Then again, you have a peak, comes down. What could this be? Basically a straining pattern. Again, remember, a low peak curve is classical of a benign prostatic enlargement. As we have already discussed, this low peak curve can be either because of bladder outlet obstruction or your underactive bladder. What about this plateau curve or your box-shaped curve? It is classical of your stricture urethra. So in stricture urethra, remember your Q max will be Q average. Okay. Then what about your straining curve? Basically, it will have a lot of fluctuations, that is continuous. Again, this is an example of a neurofilamentary curve where the tracings are intermittent. The tracings are not smooth but continuous. In other words, they are not touching the baseline. So this would complete the eurofilamentary. Next, moving on to multi-channel eurodynamics. So first we'll see the various channels and the tracings of multi-channel eurodynamics. You measure the bladder pressure, that is known as your P vesicle, by means of a catheter in the bladder. Then you measure the abdominal pressure by a catheter in the rectum, or probably you can also keep in the vagina in females, that is known as your P abdominal. But the main inference you must get is your pressure in the detrusor, that is got by subtracting this P vesicle minus P abdomen. Then there are two more catheters, one sensor in the tub that will help you to understand the flow, a sensor in the bladder that will help you to calculate the volume that is infused, and then there is tracing to basically understand the electrical activity of the sphincter, that is known as your sphincter electromyograph. So these are the various channels of multi-channel eurodynamics. So what are the various pressures? We have the intravesical pressure, which is measured by a catheter in the bladder, which is nothing but a combination of your abdominal pressure and your detrusor pressure. Then you have the intra-abdominal pressure, that is known as P abdomen, that is measured by a catheter in the rectum or the vagina. Then the important pressure, which is actually calculated by subtracting the P vesicle from P abdomen from P vesicle, that is known as your detrusor pressure. So remember, the pressure that is exerted by the detrusor is not calculated directly by the catheter, but it is just a mathematical calculation by subtracting the intra-abdominal pressure from the intravesical pressure. We have a nice cartoon to explain such a measurement. We'll see in the next slide. So next is you measure in the pressure flow studies, you measure the various pressures like your detrusor pressure, and when you just combine this detrusor pressure at the time of Q max, what you get is P det at Q max. So based on this value called P net and at Q max, you can have various inferences like your bladder outlet obstruction index, bladder contractility index. We will see all those things in the future slides. Next is your catheter in the urethra, which measures the urethral pressure profilometry. Basically, remember, it is a pressure needed to just open a closed urethra, that is known as your maximal urethral closure pressure. Next is your electromyograph. Remember, we've already discussed this electromyograph. Basically, we understand that we measure the electrical amplitude or the voltage in the pelvic floor muscles and not on the sphincter, basically, because both of them have the same innervation. So these are the various pressures, and how to calculate the mathematically the detrusor pressure, we will see this in this cartoon. So remember, if you look at the P vesicle, remember it is a combination of P detrusor, that is the pressure that is exerted in the bladder, and that pressure that is exerted by the abdomen. So remember, P vesicle is actually a combination of P abdomen and P detrusor. And how do you calculate the P abdomen? By a catheter in the rectum. So a rectal catheter would calculate the pressure that is exerted by the abdomen. So when you subtract this pressure from the P vesicle, you get this detrusor pressure. So basically, P detrusor is calculated by subtracting the P vesicle from P abdominal. So even though it might seem a bit simple, so this is something that you must not forget. So that is why I'm stressing again and again. So remember, P vesicle pressure is something that is a combination of P detrusor and P abdomen, that is the pressure that is exerted by the abdomen. So you calculate the P detrusor are by subtracting the pressure that is exerted by the abdomen, that is your P abdomen, from the P vesicle pressure. Now, basically, you see whether the catheters are functioning well or not by asking the patient to cough. So you have asked the, you ask the patient to cough. What happens? There is a spike in the P vesicle curve. So there is a spike here. Simultaneously, there is a spike in the P abdomen because basically it is your cough that is exerted by the abdomen. So when you subtract this P abdomen from P vesicle, you do not get any spike. So this makes the, so this shows you that there is no spike. In other words, there is no detrusor contraction at this point of time. So P detrusor is a combination or the, is got by subtracting the P abdomen from P vesicle. So if the patient coughs, there is not going to be any detrusor tracing. In other words, there is no detrusor contraction at that point of time. Whereas see here, there is a spike in the P vesicle, no spike in the P abdomen. In other words, this contraction is wholly from the bladder. So that is why you get a spike in the P detrusor. In other words, if you look at a spike in the P detrusor, you immediately go back and evaluate the P abdomen. So if there is no spike here, it means that this is wholly based on bladder contraction and not from abdominal muscle contraction. So see here, there is a spike in the detrusor and similarly there is a flow in the tub. So there is an outflow. So again, coming back to the master slide, I said you can just infer the whole urodynamic tracing into two things, whether it is a failure to store or your failure to empty. If it is a failure to store the urine, then again you reclassify it whether it is a bladder problem or an outlet problem, similarly for an emptying problem. So remember, failure to store is assessed by your cystometrogram and failure to empty is assessed by your pressure flow study. So what are the inferences or what are the things you will note down in a urodynamics? You can just have this mnemonic in place. There are three C's and two S. Basically, you look for your capacity, compliance, and competence, and two S, that is your sensation and stability. But there are a lot of textbooks which say about nine C's. So around five C's in your storage phase and four C's in your voiding phase. This I would like you to take down. So what are the C's you will look for in your storage phase? You look for contractions, that is your involuntary detrusor contractions. What is this involuntary detrusor contractions called as? Yes, what is the recent terminology for this involuntary detrusor contractions? What is the recent ICS terminology, that is your International Continence Society terminology for this involuntary detrusor contractions? Yes, anybody? DO. So detrusor overactivity. Next, coarse sensation. Next, competence of the outlet. So whether the patient is leaking or anything, we'll see in the storage phase. Next, compliance. So what is compliance basically? How well the bladder accommodates urine without a concomitant increase in pressure. So basically, a bladder is a reservoir. So it should withhold urine without simultaneously increasing in pressure that much. So basically, it has to be compliant. In other words, it has to receive the urine by only minimal increase in intravesical pressure. So how well the bladder is compliant, you can see in the storage phase. And finally, you can see the cystometric capacity. So these are the 5 C's that you can deduce from the storage phase. What are the C's in the voiding phase or the emptying phase? Number one is, you can see the contractility. You can see the various pressures the detrusor gives rise to. Number two is, you can see any clinical obstruction. Then coordination. What is coordination? Basically, so coordination is nothing but your urethra must relax and your detrusor must contract while doing a urethral contraction. I mean, while the patient voids. And finally, complete emptying. Whether the patient has completely voided. In other words, you can calculate the PVR in the voiding phase. So basically, remember, there are 9 C's that you can deduce from a urodynamic tracing. During the storage phase, you can deduce 5 C's, that is known as a contraction, that is an involuntary detrusor contraction, also known as a detrusor overactivity, your core sensations, competence of the outlet, compliance of the bladder, and capacity of the bladder. During the voiding phase, you can deduce 4 C's, that is your contractility of the detrusor. Clinical obstruction you can define by means of indices such as bladder contractility index and your bladder outlet obstruction index. Then coordination of the detrusor contraction and the sphincter relaxation. If those things are not coordinated, what will you call that disease as? Anybody? If there is absence of coordination between the bladder contraction and the sphincter relaxation, that disease is known as? Actually, there are 2 answers for this. Excellent. One could be your dyssynergia, that is known as a detrusor sphincter dyssynergia, and one more answer would be, yes, what is the other answer? The other answer would be a dysfunctional voiding. So what is the difference between a dysfunctional voiding and a detrusor sphincter dyssynergia? We will discuss later. So remember, during the voiding phase, we can see the coordination between the detrusor contraction and the sphincter relaxation. And finally, you can see calculate the PVR in a voiding phase. That CU is known as a complete emptying. So first, discussing the staying with cystometrogram. So before doing this storage phase, or basically the detrusor contractions and reducing the various tracings in the storage phase, that is calculated by the cystometrogram. So how fast will you fill the bladder with saline? So basically, you have to calculate the capacity of the bladder. How will you calculate the capacity of the bladder and the filling rate? By a formula known as maximal body weight by 4. So we as residents would actually use this medium fill or a fast fill to actually complete the study earlier. But remember, the International Continence Society has recommended that you do a slow fill, because this is kind of a physiologic, because when you fill the bladder fast also, that could stimulate any involuntary detrusor contractions that would give you a lot of false results. So remember, the ICS has recommended that you do a slow filling of the bladder with saline while doing an urodynamic evaluation, basically your cystometrogram. So slow fill is around 10 to 25 ml per minute. And there is a formula to calculate the filling rate also, that is known as your maximal body weight divided by 4, expressed in ml per minute. And can you name a condition where you will use this fast fill? Yes. When will you do this fast fill? You will use this fast fill in a large bladders. So when the capacity of the bladder is around, say, 800 ml or something like that, you cannot use this slow fill, because you will be doing the cystometrogram for the whole day. So in large bladders, probably you can do a fast fill. So if the patient is already areflexic and you can calculate the bladder capacity on the voiding diary also. So basically, if the patient is having a large bladder, then you can go ahead with a fast fill. Otherwise, ICS says that you do a slow fill to calculate to fill the bladder during your cystometrogram. And during the system metrogram, I said lot of C's you can find out. Contractions, we'll see what is that detrusor or involuntary detrusor contraction, also known as your newer term called detrusor overactivity. Older terms would be your detrusor hyperactivity or detrusor reflexia. Other things are core sensations. So what are the various sensations you will note down during your systemetrogram is the first sensation of bladder filling. So remember what is this first sensation is. Remember, do not confuse it with the sensation that is given by the temperature of the fluid. For example, if you are doing a systemetrogram, even in a 10 ml or 15 ml, the patient will say that he is having some sensation of your bladder filling. When you actually ask him or her whether you are feeling a sensation of cold or something, or really you are feeling a sensation in the bladder, then they will say that no, it is the temperature that they are feeling. So remember, that cannot be taken as the first sensation. The first sensation is the volume at which the patient becomes aware of the bladder filling. Next, the first desire to void is the place at or the volume at which the patient would like to void, but it can be delayed. There is no fear of leak. Again, strong desire is there is a persistent desire. The first desire is there is a desire, then it wanes away. There is a strong desire to void is a persistent desire to void without fear of leak. Next, the volume at which the patient he needs a permission to void. He thinks that his bladder has reached that capacity that is known as your systometric capacity. And then if you are still filling the bladder, then the patient will ultimately leak by the side of the catheter. That is known as your maximal systometric capacity. So basically, it is a volume in the bladder at which the patient can no longer delay the micturition. And then coming to the next point during the systometrogram is your compliance. As I had said already, what is meant by compliance? Basically, your bladder is a reservoir. It has to accommodate the urine without concomitant increase in pressure. So how well the bladder can accommodate without a concomitant increase in pressure, that is known as a compliance of the bladder. So it is given by a mathematical formula called delta V by delta P. So basically, the bladder should receive the urine and there should be very minimal increase in pressure in the bladder. So that is based on the viscoelastic properties of the bladder. If the pressure is going to increase as the volume of the bladder is going to increase, then it will be detrimental to the upper tracts. And what is that volume? Is known as your DLPP. So we'll again discuss this DLPP now. So what is this DLPP is? If the DLPP is greater than 40 centimeters of water, then studies have found that it is going to be detrimental to the upper tracts. In fact, the recent studies, they have reduced this 40 to 30 and 28 also, but there is not going to controversies for all practical purposes. In other words, for exam purposes, remember that DLPP should be, if the DLPP is greater than 40, then it is going to be detrimental to the upper tract. So what is this DLPP? So in the absence of a detrusor contraction or an abdominal contraction, the lowest detrusor pressure at which the urine leakage occurs is known as your DLPP. So remember, I repeat, there is no abdominal contraction, there is no detrusor contraction. And in such a scenario, the lowest detrusor pressure, so the lowest PDET at which the urine leakage occurs is known as your DLPP. So what is this DLPP? See this cartoon? You are filling it, you're filling the bladder, then the pressure in the bladder raises. At this point, that is the minimal pressure. At this point, the patient leaks urine from the side of the catheter. What does it indicate? It indicates that the bladder cannot withhold any more urine without concomitant increase in pressure. In other words, in an awake patient, what is going to be there in an awake patient? Awake patient without catheter, what is going to be there? His external sphincter is going to be closed. Okay. So if the DLPP is going to increase after 40, then he will have reflex into the upper tract. Please leave a message in the chat box if you can understand this point. It's a very important concept, the whole concept of urodynamics. There is one pressure that you measure by the urodynamics, one important pressure that you measure by this urodynamic, that is going to be a DLVP only. So remember, DLVP is basically the minimal detrusor pressure at which leak occurs in the absence of a detrusor contraction or an abdominal contraction. So what during urodynamic evaluation, what happens? You have a catheter in the bladder. So you have a catheter in the bladder, which means that you are negating the effect of your external urethral sphincter. In other words, you are keeping the bladder outlet open. So that is why the urine leaks on the side of the catheter. Whereas in an awake patient, what happens is urethral sphincter is closed during bladder filling. So in such a situation, if the pressure in the bladder raises greater than 40, they have found out by a lot of studies, if it is raises greater than 40, it cannot empty here because the external sphincter is closed. So during this procedure, during this scenario, what happens? It will get reflex to the upper tract and it is detrimental to the upper tract. That is known as a detrusor leak point pressure. So remember, I repeat, detrusor leak point pressure or bladder leak point pressure is the lowest detrusor pressure at which leak occurs. So it is the lowest pressure at which leak occurs. If it is greater than 40 centimeters of water, then it is going to be detrimental to the upper tract. Do you guys understand? So why it is going to be detrimental to the upper tract? So if the pressure raises above 40, what is going to happen is it should actually leak, but leak is not going to happen because your external sphincter is closed. So what will happen? The urine will reflux into the upper tract. So even if you do not understand the concept, you remember this number and the term. If the DLPB is going to be greater than 40 centimeters of water, then it is going to affect the upper tract. Why? Because your bladder outlet is not open at that point of time. On the other hand, if the DLPB is say around 10 or 15, what does it mean? The patient leaks even in a 10 centimeter of water pressure. So if he's going to leak at 10 centimeters of water or 15 centimeters of water, then it is supposed to be a safe bladder. Even though he's incontinent, what it generally means is it is not going to reflux into the upper tract. This is not going to happen. So remember, DLPP, if it is greater than 40 centimeters of water, for example, you have an overactive bladder patient or some patient and you measure the, some voiding UTS patient, you measure the DLPP, if it's going to be greater than 40, around 50 or 60, then remember that his bladder is an unsafe bladder. The urine is already refluxing into the upper tracts. It is already causing damage to the upper tracts. Okay. So this is about DLVP. So what is this compliance? So compliance, basically, you can just see the P-date. So where is the P-date? Here is the P-date. In the P-date, in the storage phase, see the pattern of curve. It should be almost flat like this. See here, it's almost flat, isn't it? Minor increase. This increase probably because of a small detrusor contraction, but on the whole, see the pattern. It is almost flat during the storage phase. So what is compliance is, you can of course measure the compliance by means of a value that is given by the formula called delta B by delta P. But on the whole, you see the compliance by seeing the tracing of the P detrusor during the storage phase. So during the storage phase, if it is almost flat, then it is a nicely compliant bladder. Okay, whereas look at this, look at the curve, look at the P detrusor, look at the storage phase, look at the curve. Keep on rising. As the volume increases, the pressure inside the bladder is increasing at one position at which it leaks. What is this pressure? What is this pressure called as? Is anybody in the chat box? Yes. See, as you are infusing the bladder with saline, the pressure in the bladder is raising. Why is it raising? Because it is a very poorly compliant bladder. See the type of curve? It is just raising like this. At one point where the arrow shows, at this pressure, it leaks. So what is this pressure called as? Yes, anybody? Excellent. It is known as your DLPP. So it is a minimum pressure at which your leak occurs without any bladder contraction. So is there any bladder contraction? No. So basically, there is no bladder contraction, no abdominal contraction, but your See, there is no abdominal contraction here. No bladder contraction, no abdominal contraction, but the minimal detrusor pressure at which leak occurs, that is known as a DLPP. Suppose in this tracing, remember the DLPP is around 66. What do you deem the bladder as? Safe bladder or an unsafe bladder? Yes, anybody? Is it a safe bladder or an unsafe bladder? Excellent. It is an unsafe bladder. See, remember the leak occurs at only 66 centimeters of water, which means that during the place between the 40 and 66, during this position, what had happened? It had, the urine had, or the saline had refluxed into the upper tract. Whereas if the DLPP is, say, less than 40, for example, 15, then it is probably a safe bladder because the urine is leaking, but the upper tracts are basically saved. So remember, what is this DLPP is? In the absence of an abdominal contraction, the minimal detrusor pressure at which leak occurs. Remember, that DLPP, if it is greater than 40 centimeters of water, how do you arrive at that 40 centimeters of water? That is because of research. They have done this UDE on various people, and they have found out that value is again a bit controversial. Let us not go there because this is mostly an MCQ based class. So whatever it is, remember, if that DLPP is greater than 40 centimeters of water, what they have found out is then the urine is going to reflex into the upper tract, that is going to be detrimental to the upper tract. In other words, DLPP greater than 40 centimeters of water is detrimental to the upper tract. Okay. Now moving on to another C. So what are the C's we have completed in the storage phase? We have completed, say, course sensations we have completed, compliance we have completed, capacity we have not completed. Now we'll let us see the competence of the outlet. So what is competence of the outlet? So during storage phase, what did I say? The bladder should accommodate. In other words, the bladder should have a low pressure, and the outlet, that is the urethra, should have an high pressure. In other words, it should be competent. So that is measured by this VLPP or ALPP or CLPP. All these things are the same. What is this? Valsalva leak point pressure, abdominal leak point pressure, and cough leak point pressure. This would define the condition known as intrinsic sphincter deficiency, which is nothing but a lead pipe urethra. In other words, the urethra cannot coapt with each other and it is not being competent. That is given by this definition called VLPP. In other words, you can define ISD by means of two values. One is this Valsalva leak point pressure, or also known as abdominal leak point pressure and cough leak point pressure. The other way of defining ISD is by this MUCP, that is your urethral pressure profilometry. It is a bit complex. We are not going to do any UPP now. So we will see what is meant by VLPP. So you guys have already known what is meant by DLPP. Now we will discuss what is meant by VLPP. So VLPP, in contrast to DLPP, remember, DLPP, what did we say? It is a minimal detrusor pressure. But what is this VLPP? It is the minimal abdominal bladder pressure. It is a minimal vesical pressure at which leakage occurs with any of these manuals, whether it is Valsalva or it is abdominal cough. So minimal bladder pressure at which leakage occurs without any detrusor contraction. So how do you measure this VLPP? You fill the bladder, then the pressure in the bladder increases, P vesicle. Then you ask the patient to do any Valsalva manner or cough. The minimal pressure at which it leaks, that is known as your VLPP. In other words, your urethra cannot hold urine even in this minimal pressure. So what is that pressure? That is the VLPP. So what is the value? If the urethra can hold up to 100, in other words, the leakage occurs only after 100, it means that there is no intrinsic sphincter deficiency. If the leak occurs even with 60 centimeters of water in the bladder, that is known as your intrinsic sphincter deficiency. The pressures between that 60 to 100 is equivocal, will not go there. So remember what is meant by VLPP, or also known as CLPP, cough leak point pressure, or abdominal leak point pressure. It is the minimal pressure in the vesicle, that is the minimal bladder pressure at which leakage occurs in the absence of a detrusor contraction while doing any maneuvers like your Valsalva or cough. So how do you measure that? You fill the bladder and ask the patient to cough. The minimal vesicle pressure at which it leaks, you measure, that is known as a VLPP. If that VLPP is greater than 100 centimeters of water, in other words, leakage does not occur as long as the pressure in the bladder, that is the P vesicle, raises up to 100, means that the urethra is nicely competent, which means that there is no ISB, no intrinsic sphincter deficiency. Next is the pressure inside the vesicle, that is the pressure inside the bladder, raises up to 60 centimeters of water itself during your cough or Valsalva, and leak occurs, means that ISD is there. Okay, now just summarizing this two leak point pressure. So what is this detrusor leak point pressure we have learned? Basically, detrusor leak point pressure, it is a measure of compliance. In other words, how well the bladder can accommodate without a concomitant increase in pressure. What is the value you are going to learn? It is 40 centimeters of water. If it is, the leak is going to occur after 40 centimeters of water, then it is going to be detrimental to the upper tract. What is meant by VLPP? VLPP is a measure of the bladder outlet, that is your urethra. It can help you to measure the intrinsic sphincter deficiency. If it is going to be greater than 100, there is no intrinsic sphincter deficiency. If it is going to be less than 60, then it is a case of intrinsic sphincter deficiency. Am I clear? Please leave a message in the chat box. This is a very important point as far as UD is concerned. Both this VLPP and DLPP, a lot of questions will come from this VLPP and DLPP only. Next to C in storage phase is your contraction. So normally, remember, there should not be any involuntary detrusor contractions during your storage phase or your filling phase. In other words, the various nomenclatures like your detrusor hyperreflexia or your involuntary detrusor contractions should not be there during your storage phase. The tracings, that is your P det during your storage phase, should be flat. Okay, what if your P det is something like this? What does it mean? Is anybody? I'm just trying to revise. See, this is storage phase. That is your filling phase. Your P det is rising as you fill the bladder. Excellent. It is a poorly compliant bladder. Excellent. Now, what if your P detrusor tracing is something like this during the storage phase? What does it mean? It means that there are lot of involuntary detrusor contractions. This involuntary detrusor contraction, according to the recent term by ICS, that is your International Continence Society, is called as detrusor overactivity. Okay, the older terms are detrusor hyperreflexia and so on and so forth, but the recent term is detrusor overactivity. Now, the next question arises, how much this pressure raise should be? Now, this pressure raise, how much this value is an older term. So then the older nomenclature, what they said is the minimum pressure to define as an involuntary detrusor contraction should be around 15 centimeters of water. But recent nomenclature and the recent the guidelines say that any raise, even 5 centimeters of water or 7 centimeters of water, if it raises also, if it is 5 or 7 also, it could be termed as involuntary detrusor contraction. So this older topic of 15 centimeters of water that must be there to define it as an involuntary detrusor contraction, that is a detrusor overactivity, is no longer valid. Now, the ICS again further classifies the detrusor overactivity into various types. What are those? They are phasic DO, terminal DO. Basically, there are two types, phasic DO and terminal DO. Then there are other types also, which are kind of self-explanatory. The patient is having a neurogenic problem, and simultaneously, if he's having a detrusor overactivity, that is known as a neurogenic detrusor overactivity. And the patient is having a detrusor overactivity, involuntary detrusor contraction, without any neurogenic cause, or you cannot find out any cause, that is known as your idiopathic detrusor overactivity. If the patient is having a detrusor overactivity and he's having a simultaneous incontinence, that is known as your detrusor overactivity incontinence. Then the patient is having a detrusor overactivity there is this newer term called DHIC, detrusor hyperactivity with impaired contractility. So what is this is the patient is having a contraction during a storage phase, but it is not good for you to void. In other words, the even though the patient is hyperactive in the sense that he is having a lot of storage symptoms like a frequency or urgency and nocturia, but the involuntary detrusor contractions are not good enough for you to void, for the patient to void. In other words, the patient will present with mixed symptoms. Mixed LUTS. Why mixed symptoms? Basically, he's having a detrusor hyperactivity, meaning that he is going to have a storage LUTS, that is a frequency urgency nocturia, but those are not good enough for you to void. In other words, he's also going to have your voiding symptoms. So that is a recently defined entity called DHIC, detrusor hyperactivity with impaired contractility. Now, we'll just base our discussion on these two types of detrusor activity. What is this? Phasic DO and terminal DO. So what is this phasic DO is, there is a waveform, that is, there is a involuntary detrusor contraction during the storage phase. That is your PDET. But this is not there. I mean, this is not there at capacity. In other words, during the storage phase, there are a lot of involuntary detrusor contraction that are, you know, like crest and trough. That is known as your phasic DO. If these involuntary detrusor contraction, if they occur at capacity, capacity means at bladder capacity. So here, there are a lot of phasic DOs. Then there is a strong contraction. In other words, as the name indicates, it is terminal. So at capacity, at bladder capacity, there is a strong detrusor contraction, and this is associated with a leak. Where is a leak? See, in the flow, there is a leak. At capacity and associated with a leak, that is known as a terminal detrusor overactivity. So I'll just repeat, what is in my detrusor overactivity? So detrusor overactivity is nothing but a newer term for an involuntary detrusor contractions. So remember, during the storage phase, that should be the detrusor pressure readings must be flat. In other words, there should not be any major increase in detrusor pressure. But if there are certain spikes during the storage phase, that is known as your involuntary detrusor contractions, or called as detrusor overactivity. That detrusor overactivity is of two types. One is your phasic DO, the other one is your terminal DO. What is a phasic DO? During the storage phase, there are a lot of involuntary detrusor contractions. These are not associated with any leak, because see the flow, there is no any leak. No, it is flat, there is no bump at all. Okay. On the other hand, what is meant by terminal detrusor overactivity? Terminal detrusor overactivity is an involuntary detrusor contraction that arises at capacity. Capacity means it arises at full bladder, that is the capacity of the patient. And that contraction will lead to leak. That is known as terminal detrusor overactivity. Actually, if you look at this tracing, there are at least two terminal DOs. For example, see, we are filling the patient with saline. He's having some phasic DO, then this is the capacity. So what is this? This value is around 190 ml. Okay, presume it is 190 ml. That time he's having an involuntary detrusor contraction, and that contraction is associated with a leak. So this is a terminal DO. Okay, we think that we have done some mistake. What we are doing, we are filling up the patient. He's able to tolerate well. There are no detrusor overactivities here. And then comes a nice detrusor contraction, involuntary detrusor contraction, and this is associated with the leak again. So this is another example for a terminal detrusor overactivity. So what is terminal detrusor overactivity? As the name indicates, terminal means it is arising at the end. In other words, it is arising at capacity. That is, it is arising at systometric capacity, and it is associated with a leak. What is phasic detrusor overactivity? It is a number of involuntary detrusor contractions which arise in the storage phase, which may or may not be associated with incontinence. Generally, not associated with incontinence. Next, how do you define bladder outlet obstruction? By a combination of flow changes and detrus are pressures. So as we have already discussed, your uroflowmetry, if it is a low peak curve, it cannot differentiate whether it is a case of bladder outlet obstruction or a detrus or underactivity. And how do you actually define whether the patient is really obstructed or not? By means of this pressure flow study, which takes into account both the flow characteristics and the detrus or pressures. We have a question in the chat box. Is presence of leak mandatory for calling it terminal DO? Yes. The definition says that terminal DO is associated with incontinence. Okay. So how do you actually define bladder outlet obstruction is by means of this various pressures. One is your bladder contractility index, which help you to define an underactive detrus. So what is this formula for bladder contractility index? Yes, we've already discussed this in your BPH class. It is a combination of P det at Q max. So what is P det at Q max? Nothing. What is the detrus pressure at maximal flow? So what is the maximal flow here? Here, around 8 ml per second. At this juncture, what is the pressure? That is known as your P det at Q max. So P det at Q max plus 5 times of Q max. That gives your bladder contractility index. So that bladder contractility index can be defined if it is greater than 150 or 100 to 150 or less than 100. So if it is greater than 150, means that it is a strong contraction. If it is less than 100, it is a weak contraction. 100 to 150, again, equivocal. Similarly, we have one more value called as bladder outlet obstruction index. Also known as, what is the other name for bladder outlet obstruction number? Or bladder outlet obstruction index? I've just given you a clue. It is also known as some number, AG number. Yes, can you just elaborate it? What does AG stand for? Yes. Abrams-Griffith number. So what is BOI is? P det at Q max minus 2 Q max. So the values are greater than 40, means that it is an obstruction. 20 to 40, equivocal. Less than 20, non-obstructed. So remember, AG number or bladder outlet obstruction index and bladder contractility index, which helps you to see whether the contraction is underactive or a normal contraction. Remember, both this BCA and DOI, remember, these are applicable only for a male person. So you cannot be calculating this DOI or your bladder contractility index for a female individual, basically. Okay, so both BOI and bladder contractility index is generally for a LUTS patient who is a male to define whether the patient is really obstructed or not. For females, we have a different value of Qmax and the period. We will just discuss that in a few moments. So remember, both these values of BOI, that is greater than 40, that shows you an obstructed obstructed system, obstructed lower urinary tract, and a bladder contractility index, which helps you to define whether the bladder contraction is good enough or not. Both these formulas are applicable only for male. So in the pressure flow studies, what are the terminologies you will use? So we have completed the systrometrogram. So the systrometrogram will see the, will calculate the compliance capacity of the systrometric capacity, involuntary detrus or contractions, force sensation, and competence of the outlet given by your VLPP. Whereas in pressure flow study, what are the various terminologies we use? We'll define the urethral function, whether during voiding if it is opened or not, or in an abnormal urethral function can be defined as, it could be because of your bladder outlet obstruction, which is given by high pressure contraction and a low flow. dysfunctional voiding and detrusor sphincter dysplasia. Remember, both these things are basically same, where there is loss of coordination between bladder contraction and urethral relaxation. So if there is loss of coordination between the bladder contraction and urethral relaxation, and the patient is having a neurogenic condition, for example, if the patient is having a spinal cord injury, or the patient is having a multiple sclerosis or a transverse myelitis or something like that, that condition is known as DESD, detrusor external sphincter dysplasia. The patient is not having any neurogenic problem. Basically, if it is a learned disability, that is known as a dysfunctional voiding. Okay. So remember, both this dysfunctional voiding and detrusor sphincter dysplasia are basically the same. You call it as DSD if the patient is having an underlying neurogenic problem. If the patient is not having any neurogenic problem, then it is called as dysfunctional voiding. Okay. Then there is one more thing called non-relaxing urethral sphincter obstruction. Again, this was asked in one of the institute exams. When will you get this non-relaxing, non-relaxing urethral sphincter obstruction? Basically means that your urethral sphincter is not contracted, not relaxed, but it is frozen somewhere in between. That condition you will get in a higher spinal cord injury, like a C2 or C3 injury. So in the case of a C2 or a C3 spinal cord injury, what you get is a non-relaxing frozen urethral sphincter, that again is a type of an abnormal urethral function. So as I said earlier, both the bladder contractility index and bladder outlet obstruction index are only for males. For females, there are lot of association giving various values, but the general accepted dictum is Qmax of less than 12 and PDET at Qmax of greater than 25 means that the case of bladder outlet obstruction in females. So basically, to define bladder outlet obstruction, what should be there? There should be high pressure in the bladder and low flow from the outlet. So if the outlet, if the flow is less than 12 and the pressures in the bladder, that is PDET at Qmax, is greater than 25 centimeters of water, you can call that as bladder outlet obstruction in females. Whereas for males, you have lot of formulas like this, bladder outlet obstruction, and you have a lot of nomograms also. You have ICS nomogram, that is basically your Abrahams Griffith nomogram. You have Schaffer nomogram and Leiva's nomogram. A lot of nomograms are there. We will not go that much in detail, but remember, for females, the general accepted value is Qmax less than 12 milliliter per second, and PDET at Qmax are greater than 25 centimeters of water is used to define bladder outlet obstruction. Now, what are the various parameters that you record on a during a pressure flow study? We have already seen, you can see the Qmax, just like your uroflowmetry, Q average, then detrusor pressure, PDET at Qmax and PDET at max. So what is the usage of PDET at max is when the patient is in retention. In other words, the patient is not able to void. If the patient is not able to void, then there is not going to be any Qmax at all. So the pressure generated in the bladder is that time called as PDET at maximal flow. That maximal flow is nothing. The patient is in retention, he's not able to void. You just see the pressure in the bladder, that is known as PDET at max, or in other words, just PDET. Then voided volume, just like uroflowmetry, you can see, and you can see the pattern, whether the strain pattern, it is a continuous or fluctuating, you can see. Then of course you can calculate the post-voidal residue and see the EMGs. So this is a classical example of a bladder outlet obstruction. See the PDET here, a nice contraction is there during the voiding. Remember, this is a storage phase. In the storage phase, what is the comment on the compliance? You see the PDET, this is the PDET, and what is your comment on the compliance of the bladder in the storage phase? Remember, storage phase is the place where you comment on the compliance. Good, both the compliance is good and your answer is also good. Remember, it is a nicely compliant bladder. If this tracing is somewhere like this, you call it as poor compliance. So just see the type of curve in the storage phase. It is a nicely compliant bladder. Then this is a storage phase, this is the voiding phase. Why I'm saying it is voiding? this is where it is voiding, because the flow is there, nice contraction is there, but the flow is very poor. See, the Q-nonce is only 9 ml per second, but the contractions are nice, but the flow is poor. This is a classical example for bladder outlet obstruction. In other words, good bladder contractions, good retrosar pressures, but poor flow. Take this instance again. What is the compliance here? How is the compliance here? Is anybody good or bad? Good. Okay. What are these? What are these spikes? Is anybody? What are these spikes called as? No, don't call it as involuntary retrosar contraction. Use the correct terminology, that is DO. Okay, good. It is a case of retrosar overactivity. Next question is, what type of retrosar overactivity? Anybody? We have said lot of at least two main types. Is it phasic or a terminal? Yes, it is phasic. Why is it phasic? Because there is it comes in the storage phase and there is no leakage. It does not come at capacity. Why is this is not capacity? Because even after this retrosar contraction, you are able to fill the bladder. Okay, so this is a classical example of a phasic DO. But our discussion is not going to be there. I'm just trying to revise. So what is the tracing in the voiding phase? Why I'm calling this as voiding phase from here? Because this is the place where the patient said I have a feeling to void, and his Qmax is not great. 13 ml per second, and look at the PDEC, contractions are so poor. In other words, what does this curve indicate? Is anybody? What does this urodynamic tracing indicate? Why the patient is in poor flow? Why the patient is having a poor flow? Because of? Is anybody? Poor retro? No. Why do you call it as bladder outlet obstruction? The PDEC is very poor. It is not like this, no. PDET is poor. Let me just say the PDET at Q max is just around 10. This is not bladder outlet obstruction. Yes, excellent. This is a classical example for an underactive detrusor or underactive bladder. So what is underactive bladder basically? Low flow and low pressure. So basically you define whether the patient is having an underactive detrusor or not by using the nomograms only, but I'm just trying to say without nomograms. So nomograms is the place where you will, Schaffer nomogram or Leber's nomogram is the place where you, or your ICS nomogram is the place where you plot the PDET at Qmax and the Qmax, that is your flow ml per minute, in on a chart, on a nomogram, and it will show you whether the patient is obstructed or not. Or you can also calculate the BOOI, bladder outlet obstruction index. You can calculate, and by taking into account the PDET at Qmax and Qmax, and using the formula and seeing the values, if it is less than say 100 or 100 to 140 or greater than 140. So this is a classical example of an underactive detrusor. I think you guys are clear with the systemetrogram and you have some fair idea about your pressure flow study. Now let us move on to electromyogram. So what did I say about electromyogram? So you are basically recording the voltage of the external sphincter, but in reality you are not actually recording the voltage of the sphincter. There's a question in the chat box. Had this been associated with leak? Yes, phasic DO. Yeah, he's having a doubt whether this detrusor overactivity can still be called as detrusor overactivity if there was a small leak here. For example, if there is a small leak here, this is the flow. What did I say? Again, going back to the definition, phasic DO can be associated with leak. It comes in phases like a crest and trough. And remember, it does not come at capacity. In other words, after this DO also, you are able to fill the bladder. In other words, this is not the place where the bladder has attained the systometric capacity. So you cannot call this as terminal DO. You call this as phasic DO. So phasic DO can be associated with a leak or not, but phasic DO is something that does not occur at systometric capacity. Okay, am I clear? For example, if you are not able to fill the bladder here, there was a contraction here, involuntary detrusor contraction, and it was associated with leak, and you are not able to fill from here on. If this had not happened, then you will call this DO as terminal DO. Okay, so remember, basically phasic DO is something that occurs in the storage phase. It can be associated with leak, that is not mandatory, but it does not occur at systometric capacity. The terminal DO is something that occurs at systometric capacity and it is associated with the flow, that is a leak. So again, coming back to EMG, so what did we say? EMG is something that you record the voltage in the sphincter, but basically you do not actually record the voltage tracing in the sphincter, but you record the tracings of the pelvic floor muscles, because you can use two types of electrodes. You can use the patient-friendly surface patch electrodes, just like your ECG leads. You can keep those in the perineum, near the perineal body, and so on. Or you can use the needle electrodes where you actually pierce the patient. It is not that much patient friendly, but it supposedly has better tracings. Whatever it is, you are just measuring the voltage values of the pelvic floor. That is an indirect indication of the sphincter activity, because both the sphincter and the pelvic floor muscles have the same nerve supply. That is your pudendal nerve. Okay. When you look at the EMGs, what you must understand is not the amplitude. In other words, you don't calculate the amplitude values exactly to look for the sphincter function, but in contrast, you look at the pattern change. So the change of pattern is what that defines the sphincter activity. For example, see here, this is a sphincter EMG. You do not worry really if the voltage is high, or here it is high, or anything like or something like that. But see the pattern. Now there was no activity in the sphincter at all. Suddenly there is a spike in the sphincter. Why there is a spike in the sphincter? Can anybody answer this? It's not an easy question, but I think you guys can answer it. See, there is a spike in the sphincter activity. Can you see here? This is again a spike in the sphincter activity. Why was there a spike in the sphincter activity? To answer this, just go and look at the P abdominal value or P abdominal tracing. So remember, the patient had coughed there. Okay, so when you actually cough, there will be increase in the sphincter activity. That is known as your guarding reflex. Okay, so he had a cough here. Basically, P abdominal was increased, and simultaneously his sphincter activity is also increased. So basically, when you look at the sphincter EMG, rather than looking at the voltage, just see the pattern. It was all docile here, and suddenly there is an activity. It is all docile here, and suddenly there is an activity. So basically, during EMG, you have to see the pattern change rather than the absolute voltage. That is the point I wanted to convey. And of course, you can check for the bulbo cavernous reflex even on an UD examination. That is ultra urodynamic evaluation. You can check the bulbo cavernous reflex. What is the root value for bulbo cavernous reflex? Yes. What is the root value for bulbo cavernous reflex? Yes. 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 2, 3, 4. So basically, how do you bulbo cavernous reflex test? You in a male, if you had already a catheter in place, you just tuck the catheter, or you just squeeze the glands. In females, you just squeeze the clitoris or tuck the catheter if there is a catheter in place, and you can see the anal tone that is getting increased. Basically, you are just stimulating the bladder neck. Basically, so when you tuck the catheter, you are stimulating the bladder neck, and you can see the increase in the anal tone. So similarly, you just tuck the catheter while doing a urodynamic evaluation and look for the tracings in the EMG, sphincter EMG. That activity will suddenly increase. So that indicates that your bulbo cavernous reflex is intact. In other words, clinically also you can find out the integrity of the bulbo cavernous reflex. Even on an EMG, even on UD, with the help of an EMG, you can calculate the integrity of the bulbo cavernous reflex. we have already discussed is Gorning reflex. So basically, during any coughing or stressing or any involuntary detritus or contractions also, the sphincter will try to increase its voltage and there will be a sudden change in pattern that will help you to prevent the leak of urine. So during EMG, you have to look for the pattern change and see the relaxation. So a slide which I had already mentioned to you earlier, what did I say during the physiology? It is your urethral relaxation that should precede the bladder contraction. So remember, when the signal arises from the spinal cord, first the signal arises gets delivered to the sphincter, it will relax, and only then there will be a slight microsecond difference between the urethral relaxation and the bladder contraction. In fact, the urethral relaxation would precede the bladder contraction. That also you can find out by means of this EMG. And what is the loss of coordination between the sphincter contraction and the sphincter relaxation and bladder contraction called as? It is known as your DSD. And there is a neurologic condition like your spinal cord injury or multiple sclerosis or any other condition, transaminitis. If there is no neurologic cause, you call that condition as dysfunctional voiding. Basically, both are the same. Then moving on to video urodynamics, you can simultaneously do a VCUG while doing, you can just record the whole process on a fluoroscopy, that is also video urodynamics, or you can not have that facility, you can probably combine the MCU, that is your voiding system urethrogram, with the urodynamic tracing and try to correlate that, because as they say, a picture is worth a thousand words and all that. So whenever possible, try to do a video urodynamics. So what are the additional information that you get on a fluoroscopy or a video urodynamics or a VCUS? You can see any reflex of urine into the ureter. You can see the shape of the bladder, whether filtry appearance of neurogenic bladder is there, any prolapse is there. Prolapse, of course, you can find out on a clinical examination. Cystocele is there, or any continency. See for any DESD or Fowler syndrome, Hinman syndrome, all those things. You can see nicely your bladder contracting, your posterior urethra getting dilated, and there is a block at the level of external urethral sphincter. So dysfunctional voiding, DESD, all those things can be very well pictorially, diagnosed by your fluoroscopy. So whenever possible, try to do a video urodynamics rather than just a urodynamics. So this is an example of a yes. Can anyone answer this? A bladder is there and there is some prolapse. So this is a cystocele. Okay. What is the diagnosis here? Is anybody? Let me just give you some context. This was taken during a storage phase. Excellent. There is reflux of urine into the ureter. So that is what did I say? There is a storage phase because the posterior urethra has not yet opened. So what would you call this reflux as? A reflux that occurs in the storage phase. High grade or low grade? Yes. Is anybody high grade or low grade? A reflex that occurs during the storage phase of film. Excellent. It is a high grade reflex because even during filling, the bladder is so non-compliant and it is reflexing in the upper tract. So it is a high grade reflex. Good. What is this? Let me give you some context. The patient is trying to void, but is not able to, and he does not have any neurologic problem. He is not having any neurologic problem and he is trying to void. Excellent. It is a case of dysfunctional voiding because see here, there is loss of contrast after the posterior urethra. Basically, the urethra is non-relaxing. it is not associated. I gave a context that it is not associated with any neurological condition, then it is a case of a dysfunctional voiding. Same patient, this is in a case of transverse myelitis or tethered cord syndrome, some neurological condition. Then you will call this diagnosis as dyssynergia, detrusor sphincter dyssynergia. Okay. Now, moving on to the second part of our topic, we'll have some idea or discussion into what are the problems associated with neurogenic bladder, and we will see some tracings, or we'll see what are the urodynamic results that you can expect in various types of neurologic bladder, and if time permits, we'll take some tracings also and try to go from there. So remember, neurogenic bladder is a broad diagnosis. So the bladder could be the earlier terms were UM and bladder, like a UM lesion or an LM lesion. Then came underactive detrusor, overactive detrusor. Of course, neurogenic bladder is in itself a big diagnosis. What are the disadvantages of a neurogenic bladder? If there is one thing that you must prevent in a case of a neurogenic bladder, what would that be? Yes, anybody? Is it your continence or your symptoms, that is having obstructive symptoms or storage symptoms? If there is one thing that you must take care or you must prevent or you must try to treat in a case of neurogenic bladder to prolong his lifetime, what would that be? That would be this one. The first part of the slide, you evaluate the upper tract status. So neurogenic bladder, the major problem with neurogenic bladder is the high pressure bladder could be unsafe. It could reflex into the upper tract and would cause upper tract damage. It could cause upper tract infection, UTI, pyelonephritis, and stone formation. It can cause other. The next important thing is only going to be your symptoms. So symptoms could be your storage symptoms or voiding symptoms. There could be incontinence, total retention, and urine leakage, and all skill excoriations can be there. And neurogenic bladder can also lead on to stone formation and recurrent UTI. So again, a bit of physiology. Remember, during the storage phase, the pressures in the bladder should remain less. The pressure in the outlet should be high. During the emptying phase, it should be the opposite. Remember, the urethra must relax before the bladder contraction. And the second master slide amongst the whole topic is going to be this one. The first master slide, what did I say? You can just infer the whole urodynamics into two things, whether it is a failure to void or a failure to store or a failure to void. If it is a failure to store, whether it is a bladder problem or a sphincter problem. If it is a failure to void, again, whether it is a bladder problem or a outlet problem. Similarly, the second master slide is this one. So what is this? This is the voiding neural anatomy. So if I ask you, name a position, I mean, name one center or one place. So we have almost six things right here: bladder, sphincter, peripheral nerves, sacral spinal cord tracts, pontine micturition center, and suprapontine. Which place would you call as a switch? Based on which our whole voiding depends on. Yes, anybody? Excellent. It is your pontine micturition center. So remember, I'll just try to simplify this whole thing. If everything between the pontine micturition center and the bladder and sphincter are good, you will have what is known as uninhibited normal voiding, but that is involuntary. In other words, if everything between the pons and the bladder and sphincter is good, you will behave like a infant. Basically, you will void well. In other words, the sphincter will relax before the detrusor contraction, and during the storage phase, the bladder will nicely accommodate. The compliance will be good. During the storage phase, your urethra is going to be closed. And during the voiding phase, it is going to relax and the detrusor is going to contract. You will have an uninhibited synergistic voiding. If everything between the pons and the outflow organ, that is your bladder and sphincter, is good, but that would be involuntary. For the voiding to be voluntary, in other words, for having a volitional control, you have some control, you have the higher centers, that is your supraponent center, basically your cortex and paraaqueductal gray. Okay, so I'll just repeat. So if everything between the pons and the bladder and sphincter is good, what will happen? As the bladder gets filled up from the kidneys, the urine, it will send signals to the sacral spinal cord. The sacral spinal cord will send signals to the pontine micturition center. Pontine micturition center, if it does not have any signals from the upper, from the higher centers, if it does not have any any stimuli from the higher centers like your cortex or your paraqueductal gray, what will it do? It will send the signals back to the sacral cord, go ahead and urinate. So the sacral cord will first ask the urethra to relax. It will next ask the bladder to contract. No, it just separated by a microseconds or milliseconds, then you will have a synergistic voiding. But if there is a suprapontine region, that is your, if there is an intact cortex and paraqueductal gray, then that will say, no, this is the right time to void. Now you try to withhold the urine. Basically, your higher centers are having an inhibitory effect on the pontine micturition center. It will guide, or it will say, now this is the time to void. No, this is not the time to void. Whereas your pontine micturition center, if it is not having any control from the higher centers, for example, if the patient is having a stroke or some suprapontine lesion, then your uninhibited synergistic voiding will be there, but that will not be under any volitional control. That will not be under any voluntary control. So remember, this is the second master slide I want you to remember. Remember, the switch, important switch, is going to be your PMC, that is your pontine micturition center. The pontine micturition center, if it is intact, it will send signals to the sacral micturition center, and there will be uninhibited synergistic voiding, just like any fat. That whether that is under volitional control is based on the suprapontine region. I'm just trying to repeat the facts, because this is supposed to be a basis for understanding the rest of the neurogenic bladder. So how will you evaluate a neurogenic bladder? These are all a bit theoretical. So you have to get a history examination and laboratory evaluation. So amongst in the history, we have to ask how long the patient is having that neurogenic condition. How is it useful? Why am I saying how long the patient is having a neurologic condition? Because you can have an idea about what findings to expect. In other words, the patient is having a spinal injury. You are evaluating a spinal cord injury patient. He had an injury yesterday. You are going to examine him today. What will you expect? In such a situation, your history is going to expect, because you will expect only spinal shock. So there is no point in evaluating such a patient when the patient is in a spinal shock. So you have to ask how long the patient is having the neurologic conditions. Other things are just self-explanatory. You'll ask him the symptoms, whether he's having any obstructive symptors, or is your voiding symptoms or respiratory symptoms, he's having any incontinence. Then how is he actually voiding? Is he using any catheter, or he's in retention basically, or is he using any CAC or a continuous bladder drainage? Is having any UTI, and then you also look for the dexterity of the patient and hand function, basically to decide on the management, whether he'll be able to do a CAC on his own, whether he'll be able to use a continent catheterizable pouch, which is based on which your management depends. And you also ask some questions about your bowel function. Basically, what they say is a good bowel function is supposed to improve the urinary problems also. So if again the patient is saying, no, he's having constipation and he's able to empty I mean 2 days or 3 days or a weekly once only by giving enema, then again his prognosis is not going to be that much good. Then there is an important question of whether the patient had any previous episodes of autonomic dysreflexia. So what is this autonomic dysreflexia? Again, this is a very important MCQ. At least they have asked it twice. When will you get, or when will you expect autonomic dysreflexia? Yes, can anyone answer? When the spinal cord injury is at what level, or when the injury is above what level? Excellent. So remember, you guys are all very sharp. I think you just want the corona to end, the COVID to end, and your well geared off for the exam. So remember, it is an exaggerated response by the sympathetic nervous system to any stimuli, basically not only noxious, be it retention or just catheterization or any constipation or electro ejaculation, whatever stimuli is there, it can stimulate such an exaggerated response by the sympathetic nervous system to any injury above T6. So T6 and above, you can have this autonomic dysreflexia. So what is this autonomic dysreflexia? Basically, so you are having some stimulus. What are those stimulus could be? It could be your urinary retention, or it could be catheterization. See the opposite things. So basically, any retention could trigger it. Even a catheterization could trigger autonomic dysreflexia, or it could be, say, constipation. Or if you are giving enema, or if the patient is doing any electro ejaculation, or he is using any penile vibrative stimulus. Basically, any stimulus can trigger this autonomic dysreflexia. So what would be the manifestations of dysreflexia? It would be an uninhibited sympathetic discharge. So basically, the patient will have hypertension, he can have bradycardia, reflex bradycardia, he can have tachycardia also, arrhythmia, he can have sweating, diaphoresis, and in fact, it could lead to his mortality also. And how would you manage? Basically, you have to identify the trigger behind the autonomic dysreflexia, and immediately you have to correct the trigger, you have to stop the procedure. For example, if you are doing any electro ejaculation or any penile vibratory stimulus, he has to stop it. If he's in retention, first you have to empty it, and then you have to treat him with drugs. Can you name some drugs that can be used to treat this uninhibited sympathetic discharge of hypertension? Yes, anybody? Just a medical question. What are the drugs that could help you to treat this uninhibited sympathetic discharge of hypertension, urgency, hypertension, emergency? Is those you would have used during your during your medicine postings? Yes. You can use nitrates, organic nitrates. You can use sodium nitroprusside. You can use. There are certain drugs which are given in our standard textbook, that is in your inner Campbell, that you can be used to prevent autonomic dysreflexia. For example, you have a spinal cord injury patient and he's going to do a penile vibratory stimulus or electro ejaculation, or you are going to do him a cystoscopy under local anesthesia or something. What you can do is probably give him a prophylactic nifedipine, or a prophylactic, say, alpha blocker like prazosin, and then do the procedure. So basically, remember, autonomic dysreflexia, the MCQ points are, the injury is T6 or higher, and there will be uninhibited sympathetic discharge. The stimulus can be anything ranging from retention to catheterization or constipation or electro ejaculation or penile vibratory stimulus. Then you look at the various manifestations and how do you treat it. You can treat it by using any drugs that help you to reduce the BP, or you can prophylactically prevent it by giving sublingual nifedipine or your alpha blockers. And staying with neurogenic bladder, for examination, you need to evaluate the motor, sensory, and autonomic reflexes. And in the cranial nerves. So in sensory, there could be dorsal column sensation and lateral spinothalamic tract sensation. Let us not go into details of all those. But what you can understand is there is something called a CACIA score. It's a screen or book. What is it? I think it's based on American Spinal Cord Injury Association score. It has got five gradings, A to E. So A is complete injury, B is incomplete, C, D are also incomplete, and E is normal. So you can grade it by using this ACIA score. You have to evaluate the gait. You have to see the dexterity. Look for the reflexes. Basically, why do you look for the reflexes? To see whether the patient is still under, say, a spinal shock, or is in recovery phase, or he has attained that stable phase. And of course, you can check the bulbocavernous reflex also. And then the imaging will continue with upper tract imaging. You can do an ultrasound or a nuclear scan to see if the upper tracts are irreversibly damaged, if there are any scars are there, basically because of your the securotrol reflex and pyelonephritis and scar formation. You can evaluate the renal function by means of nuclear scan, split renal function can be there, or other types like your creatinine clearance and serum creatinine. Lower tract evaluation, basically you do a VCUG cystoscopy, generally not indicated unless you have any say a stone or some diverticulum or something. You just have to evaluate, or when you suspect some hematuria, some cancer is any lesion is there, you do a cystoscopy. Otherwise, you go ahead with your urodynamic evaluation. Again, just revising the previous master slide, what did I say? At the end of the at the end of the urodynamic tracing, you have to establish whether it is a failure to store or a failure to void. So if it is a failure to store, it could be either bladder or it could be outlet problem. If it is a bladder problem, the various things that can cause you to have a problem with storage would be your detritus or overactivity, or spinal cord injury, Parkinson's and stroke, which will have impaired compliance. And what are the reasons that will have that will cause a failure to store? What are the outlet problems that will cause failure to store? Is your intrinsic sphincter deficiency. So intrinsic sphincter deficiency can arise in your spinal bifida, peripheral nerve injuries during surgery, or low level lesions like your myelomeningocele. Failure to empty is basically your underactive detritus. That underactive detritus can be there basically in your spinal cord injury or your MS or peripheral nerve injury. Failure to empty because of failure of the urethra to relax can be there in dysfunctional voider or your DSD, or it can be there in your Parkinsonism, that is known as a pseudo dyssynergia. Now, what are the patterns that you expect in a neurogenic bladder? Is you can expect an underactive detrusor, that is known as a detrusor areflexia, or an overactivity. In overactivity, again, you can see whether it is a phasic overactivity or a terminal overactivity. You can see the detrusor sphincter dyssynergia better appreciated on a video urodynamics. Even on a urodynamic tracing, you can see that the sphincter is contracting during simultaneous detrusor contraction. Can you guys say what are the, how many types of DSD are there? Yes. How many types of DSD are there, and which DSD is of the worst type? Yes, can you answer? No, there are three types of DSD. What are those types? So type one is there is simultaneous bladder contraction and urethral contraction. But what happens is at the height of or at the peak of detrusor contraction, the urethra gives way. In other words, urethra is not relaxing, but during peak detrusor contraction, the urethra will relax finally. That is known as your type 1 DSD, type 1 detrusor sphincter dyssynergia. Type 2 is there is sporadic urethral contractions during your detrusor contraction. Type 3 is there is a crescendo decrescendo pattern of urethral contraction during bladder contraction. In other words, as the detrusor contracts, the activity in the sphincter EMG, the activity in the external sphincter would go up and come down, would go up and come down. And this will not allow you to void well. In other words, amongst 1, 2, and 3, which type do you think is the worst? Yes, anybody? So yes, it is type 3, which is of worst prognosis. And how can you actually treat this detrusor sphincter dyssynergia? Yes, anybody? What is the treatment? So basically, you have your bladder that is going to contract and urethra should relax, but urethra is also going to contract. How could you negate this? Probably you can do a clean intermittent catheterization, or you can leave a catheter in place that is known as your continuous bladder drainage. Do you guys know any other means of treating DSD? Yes. Basically, you have to allow the urethra to relax. Can you do something? Can you inject something in the urethra? Can you inject something in the external sphincter for it to relax? Yes, anybody? Excellent. Yes, you can inject Botox, botulinum toxin, you can inject into the sphincter. Okay, good. Any other surgery can you do? Can you do any surgery? Can you do any surgery on the sphincter and allow it to relax? Yes. What is the surgery called? Just like your anal fissure. Anal fissure, what do you do? Lateral sphincterotomy, right? Similarly, you can do an external sphincterotomy. External urethral sphincterotomy. Okay. Can you leave any device here for it to remain open permanently? What is the device? Yes, anybody? How can you treat this DSD by leaving a device in the external sphincter, which is not generally done nowadays? You can leave a urethral stent. So basically, this is not done nowadays. Now, someone is asking me in the comment whether TURP will help. So basically, TURP, what does it do? TURP means it resects the prostate, right? It resects the prostate and it will resect the internal sphincter. So if the patient is having a retrosar internal sphincter dyssynergia, as it is mentioned here, retrosar sphincter dyssynergia for all practical purposes means it is retrosar external sphincter. Of course, there is a very rare condition called retrosar internal sphincter dyssynergia also, where the internal sphincter will fail to relax during a retrosar contraction. Yes, during internal sphincter dyssynergia, your TURP, basically it is not TURP, your bladder neck incision or TUIP, where you resect the, or when you incise the internal sphincter, it can help. So the point with detrusor areflexia is detrusor areflexia could indicate either an impaired contractility or a total loss of contractility. The point I wanted to stress with areflexia is, obviously, as you can understand, areflexia means the patient is, the bladder is not going to contract, so he's going to have a large volume. But remember, even an areflexic patient can have a decreased compliance. So remember, even though you can find a large capacity bladder, it can be non-compliant. In other words, If the patient is having a large capacity bladder, it does not mean that your upper tracts are safe. So you got to measure the compliance. So this is a doubt I had during my residency. During my first years of initial years, I thought, why are we even doing augmentation cystoplasty for a bladder that is already large in size? So can you understand that the bladder is already large in size? It can accommodate 600 to 700 ml. And it's a neurogenic bladder, he's not able to work. Still, why are they posting him for an augmentation cystoplasty? Only then I came to know about this thing called, even a large capacity bladder can have a poor compliance. So to improve the compliance, what do? They do an augmentation, they can do a Botox injection, they can do, you can do a CAZ, you can do an anticholinergic drug to reduce the bladder, whatever it is. Or you can use a Laplace slot and do an augmentation cystoplasty. So remember, basically what you must understand is even a large capacity bladder can have a poor compliance. So you have to measure this DLPP, see when he is going to leak. If it is going to be greater than 40 centimeters of water, means that it is going to be detrimental to the upper tract. So if it is going to leak, say, less than 40 centimeters of water, means that he is not reflexing into the upper tract. Then it is a safe bladder. If it is going to leak after 40 centimeters of water, basically it is an unsafe bladder. So probably I should not have given the answers outright. So what doesn't matter. We'll try to deduce this urodynamic tracing. Look at the P. detrusor, okay? And say me, what is the, okay, what are the things you will learn from the cystometrogram, basically? We will again try to revise this. What are the C's? 5 C's you will learn from the storage phase. Yes, quickly, can you type in the chat box? Let me start with sensation, core sensation. Then you will see the detrusor are involuntary detrusor contractions, that is detrusor overactivity. Okay, good. Sensation, I'm not going to say because the first sensation was around 150 ml. The first sensation to void was around 250 ml. Let us not go there. And my question is, are there any involuntary detrusor contractions here? Can you look at any involuntary detrusor contraction? Yes or no? Yes? Good. No? Okay, next to C is good. Compliance. What is the comment about compliance? Good or bad? See the PDET. Good compliance. Again, great. What about the capacity? Okay, let me just see the capacity. Capacity here is 730. Okay, good capacity. What is the other thing? What is the other thing you see in a storage phase? Core sensation. Did the contract? Yes. For the other thing, 5 C's we have said, right? Or the other C? Competence of the outlet. Do you see any leak here? Do you see any leak here during the storage phase? No. So what do you think about the competence, good or bad? Yes. Good comment, excellent. Let us move on to the voiding phase. What are the 4 C's in voiding phase, did I say? Contractions, okay? Detrusor contractions. Look at the detrusor contractions. The voiding state starts here. How are the contractions? Are you satisfied with the contractions? Let me just give a tracing. Yes, there are 4 contractions. So this is a case of detrusor areflexia. Okay. The contraction should be like this. And what about your other things? What are the other things you will see in the voiding phase? Contractions. Clinical obstruction. So to define the obstruction, how will you calculate the obstruction in a male? You have to calculate the bladder outlet obstruction index, that is based on your flow. See the flow, actually it is 0, which means that there is, objectively he is having total areflexia, he is totally obstructed. And the other C is contraction, whether he has PVR, so complete emptying. Complete emptying is there, PVR is almost 730, because he has not voided. Next is coordination. So when the detrusor contracts, the sphincter should relax. Basically, there is no detrusor contraction at all. So you cannot comment about the coordination. So this is how you should, you know, should try to read a urodynamic tracing. First, you need to have a history. You need to have a voiding diary, basically. And then try to remember this mnemonic, 5 C's during your storage phase and 4 C's during your voiding phase, and try to read from there. And finally, you should see whether the patient is having a failure to store that is causing the symptoms, or failure to void. What do you think this condition is? Is it a failure to store or a failure to void? Yes, excellent. It is a failure to void. Next question is whether it is a bladder problem or an outlet problem. Whether it is a bladder problem or void? Yes, excellent. It is a bladder problem. So that will help you to localize the problem. So that is the main use of urodynamics. I think you guys are getting an expert in urodynamics. Okay, again, let me try to see how do you calculate the compliance. So basically, what did I say? Till now, I had said just look at the curves in PDET. It should be flat. If it is like this or something, that the pressure increases, then you understand that it is a poorly compliant bladder. But what is the value, absolute value is, you can calculate. One way of calculating the compliance is by using this end filling pressure. Okay, what is this end filling pressure? At capacity, just look at the detrusor pressure. For example, if this is the capacity. At capacity, look at the detrusor pressure. That detrusor pressure, if it is less than 15 centimeters of water, it means that it is a normal compliance. Okay, so remember, compliance you can just comment by looking at the curve, looking at the tracing in the P detrusor, or one more way of commenting about the compliance is by looking at the end filling pressure, provided both the P detrusor and the flow was and the volume in the bladder was zero at the start of the study. At the systometric capacity, see the detrusor pressure, and if that detrusor pressure is less than 15 centimeters of water, then it is a fairly compliant bladder. So this is a curve which we have already seen during our initial phase of the discussion. See, this is a PDET. Okay, let us try to decode it. Amongst the five C's, let us not worry about core sensation. Capacity, I would say, is 250. Again, a poor capacity bladder. What about the compliance? Look at the curve. Look at the compliance. Excellent. It is a poor compliant bladder, and this arrow indicates that he is leaking. How do you know he is leaking? Basically, you should have one more tracing here of the uroflow or the catheter in the basin that indicates a peak. Okay. I'm just trying to revise. What is this pressure called as? Is anybody? What is the pressure? Let me try to elaborate. The lowest detrusor pressure at which leak occurs in the absence of a detrusor contraction. What do you call it as? Is anybody? Excellent. It is known as DLPP. And what is this value? 66. So DLPP is 66. In other words, this is a patient who is leaking on the sides of the catheter at 66 centimeters of water. Is it safe for the upper tracts? Excellent. It is an unsafe bladder. So basically, what should you do? You should try to reduce the pressure inside the bladder. What are the ways of reducing the pressure inside the bladder? Probably you can use an anticholinergics. You can use a Botox, your botulinum injection, or you can do an augmentation cystoplasty, or you can use a CAC or a continuous bladder drainage. Okay. Now, someone has asked me, it is good that you have come out with a question. Is it DLPP or VLPP? Come on, let me just try to revise it again. What did I say about DLPP? DLPP is the lowest detrusor pressure at which leak occurs. What does it mean by VLPP? Is anybody? VLPP is the lowest pressure in the vesicle. It is not detrusor pressure basically, because it is a vesicle pressure. Of course, you can measure from the abdomen also, but the person who devised it, Dr. McGuire, he used P vesicle. So it is the lowest P vesicle at which leak occurs on V means Valsalva, on Valsalva. So basically, at this leak, there was not any Valsalva here. Can you see? So that is why it is called DLPP. Okay, there was no contraction here, no abdominal contraction or no Valsalva at this point of time. So that is why it is called as DLPP. Okay, someone is asking me in the comment, the ENG is showing peak at this region. Okay, again, don't try to take all these tracings individually. Try to see from a different perspective, in the sense that he is leaking at this point of time. So naturally, as a part of guarding reflex, what the sphincter is trying to do, it is trying to increase its voltage. It is trying to increase the amplitude of contraction. Thereby, it tries to prevent the leakage. So that is some form of a guarding reflex. Excellent. Good that you have come out with this question. Okay. Again, look at the pediatrics are here. What do you infer from the compliance? Yes. Excellent. It is a poorly compliant bladder. Because of this poor compliance, what is happening? When you look at the urodynamics, as you say, a picture is worth a thousand words. He is reflexing into the upper tracts. Again, here, a poorly compliant bladder, which is unsafe. Okay. So DSG, we have already discussed. There are three types. Type one is both the detrusor and the sphincter contracts, but at the height of contraction, the sphincter gives away. Two is sporadic urethral contraction. Three is crescendo-decrescendo type. We have discussed the various management of DSG also. So let us try to read a urodynamic tracing. Look at the P detrusor. This is the warding phase. It starts here. So there is a nice detrusor contraction. What should happen to the EMG? Yes, it should be like this, no? It should relax, but it is contracting. So this is a classical case of DESD. Again, just look at the video urodynamics, which is more explanatory than the tracings itself. You have the sphincter that is failed to relax as the bladder is contracting. How do you know the bladder is contracting? Because the bladder neck has opened, your posterior urethra has also opened. So basically, this is a voiding film, but the urethra has, external sphincter has failed to give way. Now the third master slide and probably the most important of all from an MCQ point of view would be this. So this this slide basically explains what are the findings you can expect when you have various pathologies. So as we have already discussed, that pontine micturition center is the switch on which the whole neuro-urology functions. So we can divide the lesions into those above the pons, those are suprapontine lesions, between the pons, pontine micturition center and the sacral micturition center, and below the sacral micturition center. Okay, so remember what you will infer from the future slides, which I'm going to just rush up, because you will have almost everything in every condition, is that you can have any type of urodynamic tracing or any type of problem in any neurological condition. For example, in a suprapontine lesion, generally people should have detrusor overactivity. It does not mean that he will not have any detrusor underactivity. The patient can have detrusor hyperactivity for a longer period of time, and then his bladder can decompensate at one point of time, and that time he can have a total detrusor areflex. So remember, division of suprapontine or between pons and sacral micturition center or below the sacral micturition center is just to give you an idea. But remember, any lesion, because it is not absolute that they will have only hyperactivity, that you will have only underactivity, you will have only DSD. But as a general dictum, try to understand that any lesion between the pons and the sacral micturition center, which can be because of injury or infection, tumor, infection, tapis dorsalis, or pernicious anemia, and so on and so forth, or your disc disease, will have detrusor overactivity with or without DESD, that is a dyssynergia. One dictum which generally works is any suprapontine lesion will have overactivity without dyssynergia. So remember, a suprapontine lesion like Parkinson's disease or a stroke or any thenomic problems or Schei-Dragger syndrome or cerebral palsy, cerebellar problems will not have any DSD. So DSD mostly occurs, that is your detrusor sphincter dyssynergia occurs only if there is a lesion between the pontine micturition center and the sacral micturition center. So what they say in the neuro-urology slide, if the connections in the circuit between the pontine micturition center and the sacral micturition center, if they are all good, what will you expect? Yes, this is something you should answer. Or at least trust is say this five times or so. If the circuit between the pontine micturition center and the sacral micturition center is good, what type of voiding will you expect? Good. You will expect uninhibited sinner cystic volume. In other words, your bladder will contract and your urethra will relax. So if you have some problems between the pons and the sacral micturition center, this synergistic uninhibited voiding will go away. That is when you will develop this DST. Okay, so any lesion below the sacral micturition center, generally, be it a peripheral nerve injury like a post-traumatic injury, you will have generally areflexia. Of course, you can have a hyperreflexia also. We'll try to see what percentage will come in which lesion. So remember, again, I'm trying to stress this one. Any lesion between the pons and the sacral micturition center, you will have detrusor or hyperactivity. That is a detrusor overactivity with detrusor sphincter dyssynergia. Any suprapontine lesion, you will have only detrusor overactivity without dyssynergia. And lesions below the sacral micturition center, you will have generally areflexia or an underactive detrusor. So we will try to, I'll give you the slides will be available with the app, so you can try to revise the slides. But I will just try to revise the very common conditions and the type of lesion that can come in each condition. So when you take a stroke, that is your cerebrovascular accident. So cerebrovascular accident or a stroke would come in which condition? I mean, which place? Is it a suprapontine or a pontine and sacral or below sacral? Yes, good. Let me just, for clarity, name the suprapontine as 1, between pons and sacral as 2, for the ease of answering, and below the sacral as 3, okay? So it is basically going to be a suprapontine lesion. In other words, it is going to be a type 1. So what is the urodynamics finding you will expect generally? Yes, generally you will expect detrusor overactivity without dyssynergia. But you'll have something known as pseudo dyssynergia. What is a pseudo dyssynergia? There are actually two types of pseudo dyssynergia. Basically, one is in Parkinsonism. So in Parkinsonism, what happens is, basically what is Parkinsonism? There is some problem in the nigrostriate pathway, whatever it is. There is bradykinesia. So the patient will have slower movements of almost all the muscles. So he will have bradykinesia of sphincter relaxation. So what is this bradykinesia? So what did I say? During normal physiology, what should happen? The sphincter should relax first. But what happens in Parkinsonism? That relaxation is going to be slow. So if it is going to be slow, you will have your sphincter EMG that is still contracting before it relaxes as the detrusor can. For example, this is a P detrusor. As the detrusor pressure increases, the sphincter should have reached this baseline. But there is a bradykinesia for the sphincter to relax. So that is why you get something known as your pseudo dyssynergia, especially in Parkinson's disease. So remember, any suprapontine lesions will not have DESD generally. But if you take the video urodynamics of Parkinsonism, again, it will show that the sphincter has not relaxed. That is not true dyssynergia, because the sphincter is not contracting basically, but the sphincter is not relaxing normally. It is relaxing slowly, okay? So this is what Parkinson's. So Parkinson's, again, it comes in suprapontine lesion. Basically, you will have detrusor overactivity with pseudo dyssynergia. So we'll have it often misdiagnosed. You look at the video dynamics, you will think that it is probably true dyssynergia, but it is not actually true dyssynergia. It is not actually urethra that is contracting during your bladder contraction, but it is actually the urethra that is slowly relaxing or not relaxing early enough during the bladder contraction because of bradykinesia. So let me have a urodynamic tracing. So let us go to the voiding phase directly, because you guys are all expert in the storage phase. So voiding phase, there is some flow. Qmax is around 12 ml per second. Look at the detrusor contraction. Detrusor has started to contract. P-det at Qmax is good, 55 centimeters of water. But look at the EMG, sphincter EMG. See, it is still contracting. Only then it is trying to relax. Okay? Am I clear? So actually what should have happened? During the, as the ureters are started to contract. This sphincter AMG should have gone like a base. It was like this, and it have gone to a base even before these ureters are started to contract. But still, the ureters are has not started to relax. I mean, still the sphincter has not started to relax because of bradykinesia. This is known as what is this condition is known as pseudo dyssynergia. So when you look at the spinal cord injury, again spinal cord injury can be can be cervical, thoracic, lumbar or sacral. So basically you can have any type of urodynamic tracings on a spinal cord injury. So basically it depends on which time you are going to you are trying to examine the patient. If you are going to examine the patient much early, when the patient is in a state of spinal shock itself, what will happen is that he will, in a case of spinal shock, what will happen? All the reflexes are all absent. So basically, he will have a detrusor areflexia. So it is mandatory that you do not do any urological evaluation when the patient is in spinal shock. So basically, how do you know if the patient is in spinal shock? You evaluate the rest of the reflexes. You evaluate the bulbocavernous reflex. You see whether the Babinski reflex, Babinski sign is present, and all the reflexes are there or not. So basically, you know whether the patient is in spinal shock or not. So if the patient is in spinal shock, there will not be any contraction at all. So you do not base your treatment based on the findings when the patient is in spinal shock. So after the spinal shock, he will go into recovery phase. Then he will reach a phase that is known as a stable phase. During that stable phase only, when there is this exaggerated superficial reflexes, I mean loss of superficial reflexes and that exaggerated deep tendon reflexes, during that time only, you have to go ahead and do your neuro-urological evaluation. And what are the findings you will expect? That is summarized in this chart. Again, this is some sort of a Mars slide over card. So what are the various urodynamic findings you can expect? You can expect detrusor overactivity, earlier called as detrusor hyperactivity, or you can expect detrusor sphincter dyssynergia, detrusor areflexia or underactivity, or you can expect a normal urodynamic tracing. So as you go up to a higher spinal cord injury, you will have mostly detrusor sphincter dyssynergia and detrusor hyperactivity. As you come below, you will have mostly areflexia. That is again self-explanatory from this chart. Okay. So as the injury goes higher, you will have overactivity and DSD. As the injury goes below, you will have mostly detrusor areflexia. So what you must understand from this chart is basically that you can have any type of urodynamic tracing in any type of injury. It is not that every cervical injury patient will have DSD. It is not that every cervical patient will have hyperactivity. In fact, there can be some amount of areflexia in cervical injury patient also. So in other words, in any case of spinal cord injury, in a stable phase, you have to do a neurodynamics. You cannot just base your treatment based on your MRI findings. For example, in an MRI, you can find that, based on history or MRI, if you find that he's having a thoracic injury, you cannot assume that he will have only hyperactivity. He will have DSD. It is not so. So the findings can just mix with one another. The reasons behind that is not known because we are not that much aware with what's actually happening. So basically what you must understand is higher the injury below the pons, mostly a hyperactivity and DSD will be there. As the injury goes below, mostly areflexia can be there. So that is the only thing you can understand. But remember, you have to do a urodynamic evaluation, preferably a video urodynamic evaluation for every spinal cord injury patient, especially in the stable phase. Why so? Because you cannot just base upon your treatment on the history and MRI findings. So again, let me just try to rush down some topics. So multiple sclerosis can involve the brain and the spinal cord. There will be plaque formation, so there can be hyperactivity and DSD if spinal cord is involved. What about your pelvic plexus injury? So pelvic plexus injury is something that is very important for us surgeons. So after, say, various surgeries like an APR or a radical prostatectomy or radical hysterectomy, we can injure the various nerves. So what are the nerves we can injure? We can injure the hypogastric nerve. If hypogastric nerve is gone, your sympathetic supply is gone, then your bladder neck will not be competent. If you have injured the pelvic nerve, then it will cause detrus or areflexia. If pudendal nerve is gone, you will have failure of external sphincter contraction. So you will have a lot of incontinence. So it depends on the type of injury. And the important topic is diabetes and neurogenic bladder. So again, in diabetes, remember, you can have any type of any type of urodynamic trace. You can have hyperactivity. So generally, what it is said is diabetes, people will have this diabetic cystopathy, which is a failure to have a sensation on the bladder filling, that is known as sensory impairment or known as diabetic cystopathy. But recent evidence says that just like any other neurological problems, diabetes also will start with detrus or overactivity. Then it will reach a condition of bladder decompensation. Only in that place you will have this classical detrus or areflexia, that is underactive detrus or detrus or underactive. So in other words, your diabetic cystopathy or an underactive detrus or that is commonly seen in diabetic population is probably the end organ damage of your long standing diabetes. How long it will take to reach this stage? Around 8 to 10 years. That is when you will land up in retention. So probably what the recent research is saying is classical loss of sensation, that is a diabetic cystopathy or your detrus or underactivity, is probably your end stage manifestation of your diabetes, which actually starts like with any other neurological condition with detrus or hyperactivity and so on and so forth. So conditions like MSA, basically what is the importance with MSA is MSA can have both UMN and LMN type of lesions. So there can be detrus or hyperactivity as well as there could be detrus or areflexia. The percentage varies. Brain tumor, what do you think? Brain tumor, what findings do you expect generally? It is suprapontine or infrapontine lesion. It is basically a suprapontine lesion. So generally you will expect detrus or overactivity without dyssynergia. Good. And an important condition called NPH or normal pressure hydrocephalus, it is a triad of ataxia, dementia, and urinary incontinence. So generally it is common in old age people, which is treated with, even though the pressure is normal, you will treat it with a BP shunt or some sort of shunt procedure. Again, being a suprapontine lesion, your detrus or overactivity is common. Remember, I'm just saying it is common. It is not that every suprapontine lesion will have hyperactivity only. Okay, so it can be findings can be mixed. So any suprapontine lesion can also have detrus or areflexia also. But remember, detrus or hyperactivity is going to be your most common finding. But generally, what they say is suprapontine lesions will not have any DSD. That you can take it for granted. So DSD is generally for lesions between the pontine micturition center and the sphincter micturition center, which again is self-explanatory because the circuits are correct, you will have an uninhibited synergistic voiding. So dementia, again, in dementia, you will have underactive detrus because the period at Qmax is only 10 there. Dementia, again, suprapontine lesion, you can have detrus or overactivity. Tethered cord syndrome, again, a very important diagnosis. Generally, you will see a lot of tethered cord syndromes in your residency. It generally manifests during your adolescence. As the child grows, as the child grows into an adolescent, there is cephalon migration on the spinal cord, there will be fibrosis in the lower part of the spinal cord. So generally, this will being a sacral and a subsacral lesion, it will generally cause areflexia. Of course, it can cause overactivity also. Myelomeningocele and meningocele, as you can understand, it is some problem in the sacral spinal cord, and below you can have generally areflexia, but hyperreflexia can also be there. So why I'm trying to rush is in any condition you can have anything. The only chart you must try to understand and try to correlate is the chart which I showed earlier. Where you will divide the lesions into three types: one in the suprapontine, one between the pontine micturition center and the sacral micturition center, and one below that, and try to correlate the findings there. But during various stages of the neurological problems, the findings can vary. So that is why you have to do a neurodynamic evaluation for every patient, and just based on the diagnosis of the patient, you cannot presume that he is going to have an hyperactivity, he is going to have an underactivity, I'm going to give him an anticholinergic, I'm going to give him a baclofen or something like that. So you cannot just presume, you have to do a neurodynamics for every condition. So finally, with sacral angiogenesis, again, sacral angiogenesis, as you can understand, what type of problem to expect. Generally, A reflex, again, overactivity can also be that they are seeing. So this we have discussed already, various peripheral nerve injuries, so APR or a radical cystectomy or prostatectomy, based on the nerves injured, whether it is your pelvic nerve or hypogastric nerve or your pudendal nerve, your condition will vary. Now, after evaluation with urodynamics, you have to formulate your treatment plan. Again, what did I say? At the end of any urodynamic tracing, you have to simplify it as a failure to store or a failure to void. If it is a failure to store, you have to see whether it is a bladder cause or an outlet cause. If it is a failure empty, again, a bladder cause or an outlet cause. So if it is a failure to store and if it is a bladder cause, how can it treat medically? Probably you can reduce the bladder pressure by giving anticholinergics or a botulinum toxin. Whereas if it is a failure to store because of a sphincter cause, there is no medical treatment. But there is some surgical treatment. What is a surgical treatment? Can anyone say? What is a surgical treatment where there is an outlet problem and there is failure to store? Yes, you can do any bladder outlet surgeries like a slings you can do. Or probably you can keep an artificial urethral sphincter. Yes, there is probably no medical treatment. And what about your failure to empty? If it is an underactivity, probably you can use Bethanacol. But remember, for all practical reasons, your sympathomimetics like Bethanacol, they do not work. If someone is saying that they are using Bethanacol 25 milligram, 50 milligram, 100 milligram, and then he is voiding, he's probably stress, you know, straining or just doing an abdominal voiding. It is proven beyond doubt that that sympathomimetics will not help in underactive detusor. Okay, and if it is a case of failure to empty because of an outlet problem, then it is a case of DSD. We have seen the various treatments of DSD, CIC, continuous bladder drainage, or Botox injection, or stent you can do, or a sphincterotomy. So failure to empty, what are the invasive treatments? You can either do an intermittent catheterization or a continuous bladder drainage, or do some sort of a surgery like sphincterotomy, ileal contour, or a augmentation. So what are the main advantages with intermittent catheterization? It is supposed to be clean, in the sense that it is going to be a cheaper alternative for your problem. In a sterile condition is not required, but the downside is, of course, colonization will be there. It can progress on to UTI, and it can cause false passages, strictures, and epidermarcitis, and so on and so forth. Chronic indwelling catheterization, remember, this is should be your last resort. Always try to try to proceed with CAC, continuous bladder drainage. Even though it is easy for the caregivers, there are a lot of problems associated with it because of infection, stone formation, and cancer formation. Other surgical options, if there is a failure to store, you can do an augmentation cystoplasty. If it is a failure to store because of an outlet, you can do various type of slings or an artificial urethral sphincter. Failure to empty because of bladder, you can do a neurostimulation that is known as your Brindley. Remember, this is not your interstim procedure. Interstim is different. That is a treatment for overactive bladder. This neurostimulation is for allowing the bladder to contract. That is known as a Brindley device. Okay, if it is a failure to empty and that is because of an outlet problem, what is this condition called as? Failure to empty because of an outlet problem. Yes. If it is a neurogenic, what it is called as? If it is a non-neurogenic, what is it called as? Good. If it is a neurogenic, you will call it as DSD. We have seen the various treatments of DSD. If it is a non-neurogenic cause, then it is a dysfunctional voiding. Probably how to teach them biofeedback, pelvic floor exercises, or CAC. Diversion we have already seen. You can do an ileal call to or some sort of augmentation cystoplasty.